Welcome. Tonight we share the best of our Origins Game Fair 2024 experiences on episode 246 of the Origins Award finalist Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
So we spent the past week at Origins Game Fair in Columbus, Ohio, and have lots to talk about, including the great games we saw, awesome cosplay, shows we attended, and more. Stay tuned for a day-to-day breakdown.
Just in case you're new here, I'm Sean, your host. And here with me, we have our SEO ninja and co-host, Deanna.
Hey to all the cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your nights better.
This episode was brought to you in part by our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, who did really well at Origins, and our Patreon patrons. Remember that we record this podcast live on Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode246. That's 246. Links may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
Finally, do note that we did bring home review media copies of some of the games we will be talking about tonight.
The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight, the question we are answering is, how was Origins Game Fair 2024, and was it worth attending?
So I'm going to start off plain and simple here with some gushing about Origins. I love this show. Wish I had been going longer. We only started attending this show fairly recently, really, given the length it's been around. And I love it. And I love how it's big, but not too big. And how it keeps getting better every year we attend. Well, it wasn't perfect. Nothing horrible went wrong, at least not that I heard of. There weren't any major problems, and there was a whole lot of good that we're hyped to talk about. We had a great time meeting old friends, making new ones. This includes publishers, designers, content creators, and most importantly, the number of fans we connected with. The number of people like, Mo, are you the Tabletop Bellhop? Are you the guy? And that comes from both our podcast, our YouTube, as well as the tabletop gaming deal side of things. I had more than a few people come up and thank me for saving them lots of money. Origins has always been a great show for us to attend, both professionally and personally, and this year was no exception.
Yeah, I think the first year we went was maybe 2016. If we've attended enough times now that it feels homey. It's comfy. I love Origins. You know, like a lot of the anxiety is gone because it just, it's a comfortable space. I know where I can sit to crash for a bit. I know where all the halls are. I know that I'm surrounded by my kind of people. Like, it's all gamers everywhere, and everyone is generally awesome.
Yeah. I think the size of Origins, despite what some people whine about online, is pretty perfect. There's a ton to do, but you're not packed in like sardines, as people are often complaining about at Gen Con and other of the major cons that everyone talks about. Origins still slides under the radar a little bit. And for that, there's just that little bit of space to breathe that makes it a fun, friendly con.
Now, just in case you aren't familiar with Origins Game Fair, this is a tabletop gaming convention held every year in Columbus, Ohio. It is put on by GAMA, the Game Manufacturers Association, of which we are voting members of.
So we applied as media to get Sean a discounted badge, and then Mo and I attended the event as members of the media and events arm of GAMA, and because we are GAMA members, and we were provided with two free passes as GAMA members.
Yeah, unlike GAMA Expo that Mo and Dee went to earlier this year, be sure to check out our Gamma Expo episodes for interest stuff on that con. Origins is more of a gaming and shopping con. While there are some trade elements, especially on Wednesday, which is trade day, it's all about playing games and shopping for games and game-related stuff. The exhibit hall is open from Thursday to Sunday from 10 a.m. till 6 p.m., and the gaming hall is open on Wednesday as well, until midnight every day. Added to that, there are a ton of open gaming areas and game spaces hosted by various publishers with an entire wing of the convention center dedicated to tabletop RPGs.
Now, another part of the Origins Game Fair every year is the annual Origins Award Ceremony. Now, there are awards for a ton of different categories, and we'll give you a list of some of the ones we think you'll be most interested to later. And yes, this year we were a finalist in the Best Media Production category. Now, I'll say right up front, no, we didn't win, but just being nominated is a huge honor, And we want to say congratulations to everyone who did win.
One of the things that we did different this year was we stayed at an Airbnb in the German village. We'd never done that before. We'd never stayed offsite for Origins. And of the three of us, none of us had stayed in an Airbnb before. And it was just, it was a really positive experience. The house was lovely. The German village area is amazing. And for years, people have been telling us to go check it out. We finally checked it out. And everyone else that's in Columbus for Origins, go check out the German village. It's worth seeing.
Yeah, well, while the brick streets were a bit rough on the van's suspension, the neighborhood was beautiful, and we were steps away from Schmidt's Sausage House, which was the best place we've ever eaten at in Ohio.
Yeah, and the drive wasn't bad. It was only under 15 minutes, I would say most of the time, under 15 minutes to get to the convention center, and we bought a parking pass for the Vine Street Garage, which actually costs less than daily hotel parking at the places attached to the convention center and was surprisingly closer to the exhibit halls than the hotels and garages down at the Hyatt end of the convention center. So that was an added bonus I wasn't expecting. The driving in Waze was better.
Yeah, we actually got fewer steps in. I usually try and book us the closest hotel possible, but it turns out that we didn't mind staying offsite at all, and we'll probably end up doing the same thing next year.
Yeah, I actually saw a number of threads about people talking about buying hotels for next year and people talking about how they would often get the parking pass and not pay to park at the hotels. But that's enough for the preamble. Let's get to the convention itself. Origins Game Fair, day one, Wednesday.
So one of the benefits we get as Gamma members, and this is the first time that I know of they've offered this, because if this was in the past, we totally missed it and should have used it, was a special area where we could pick up our badges, getting to skip the Wednesday morning line. And honestly, that was so nice. It was almost worth the cost of our membership on its own. There was literally no line. We walked across the skywalk, got to the pods where the Gamma member area was, where the presentations, everything were going, the member lounge, and there was a printer there, and they scanned our QR codes, and we were done. Now, yes, we did have to go to the mainline area to do material pickups, but the material pickup line is never anything compared to the badge line, so that was awesome.
Of all the cons I've ever been to, that was the single quickest, smoothest badge pickup ever.
This was kind of a game changer. Not going to lie, even when the normal reg line was short, there was still a line and steps to go through, but not for Gamma members on Wednesday morning.
So one of the benefits of being a Gamma member is that. Now, another is on Wednesday, Gamma always puts on something they call Trade Day. They get an entire pod, for anyone who knows the convention center, it's an entire area of rooms that's upstairs, where they have different presentations, you can attend. Panels, some are panels, some are presentations. And there is some benefit for retail members if they attend at least three of these, some kind of package. We're not retailers. I don't know the details. If you are a retailer and got confused, don't look at us. We checked out a few of these. Last year, we went to a few more. This year, we checked out a couple of them. One blew me, totally flipped me, because it was called Navigating the World of Wargaming. And I thought I was going to get to hear about like selling Hex Encounter and Advanced Squad Leader and stuff in game stores. Because I'm like, man, I want to know how that hobby, that side of the hobby is still doing, how it's going. But it ended up, it was a presentation on Warhammer mainly, and Marvel Crisis Protocol a bit. But fair enough, that was my fault for not reading the full description. Now, I did attend a really good panel on mentoring from Jennifer Owen, and I shouldn't know down which game store they own, but it was an FLGS owner that talked about what they've learned through mentoring and people they've mentored and who worked with them. And that one was actually really good.
Yeah. Last year, I sat in on a couple of seminars. I mean, the thing is, Trade Day is really retailer focused, and it's a great way for retailers to learn from and support each other. When we went to Gamma Expo, there were seminars that were on target for publishers and media and retailers. But Origins Trade Day really feels like it is meant specifically only for retailers, which is fine. It's just something you want to note, because if you go there and you're not a retailer, you may be disappointed.
Yeah, in my case, they weren't even especially photo worthy. They were just really, if you were the target audience, great info dumps, but not the specially media worthy events.
Now, from there, we checked out the gaming hall. Yes, the gaming hall is open on Wednesday. Pro tip, Origins attendees, all day Wednesday from like 10 till midnight. And the full gaming library is there for you to take out and use. A lot of people seem to think that the show really opens on Thursday, but it's the exhibit hall that opens on Thursday. So yes, if you want to go shopping or if you want to meet with publishers or whatever, or you want to pitch your games, yes, that's Thursday. But if you're there to play games and hook up with friends to play games or get that yearly game at Twilight Imperium in with the group you haven't seen since college, Wednesday is perfect for it. The open gaming area this year was huge. It was significantly bigger than previous years. And there wasn't a single time we walked by that I couldn't find at least one or two tables. So despite being extremely popular, there was always room to play. Now, the nice part, for anyone who's been to Origins multiple times, and even when we used to go, you used to have to pay for a badge for the board game area. That no longer exists. This is all free to use with your Origins badge, day, week, whatever badge you have.
Yeah, you go in there and you can play your own game that you bought, or you can go to the library and take out a game. And the library is, there's quite a few games. It's not one or two things. Yeah, we missed out on it last year, just realizing that it was open Wednesday, and I think it might open at noon. I'm not sure if it's 10, but okay. Still, just the fact that it's open Wednesday all day, and it's a little less busy, and it's a great mm-hmm. day to just check out the open game area and get the lay of the land. And there are some publishers in that hall as well that you can go by their booths. It gets busier later in the week, so I love getting to walk around on Wednesday.
Yeah, well, we've seen people say that the game open gaming area is small compared to places games like PAX. I think the fact that there are entire other sections of the show devoted mm-hmm. to other types of games, as well as sections devoted to specific games, makes this area for open board gaming really a respectable size. And again, it's been growing steadily, mm-hmm. but they're running into problems where they're going to start crushing some of the exhibitor space if they get too much bigger.
That's true. Yeah, because there's other, like the open gaming area is only one part of the gaming hall. In addition, there's like a Crokinole tournament area, and there's the train game, the Puffing Billy area, which didn't seem to have that name anymore. So I'm wondering if they changed their name. But there was a whole train game area that was, I don't know, one fifth of that hall. And then a bunch of the publishers had kind of rented out areas to do their demos. But in addition to that, there were lots of open tables, and most people were good with you using them. So even if that back area filled up, there was often somewhere you can find a game. Now, as Deanna mentioned, there were some exhibitors whose main booth is in that gaming hall. Our friends at Queen Games, that's what they do every year now. They're just in the gaming hall. So if you want to hook up with the Queen Games, you can do that on Wednesday. And they have demo tables going the entire weekend. Game Labs was there with a massive Battletech setup going on. And I mentioned the Crokinole that comes from Brown Castle Games. They've got tables set up all weekend. Yes, there's an official tournament, but anytime, if there's a table for you, you're welcome to go over and play, and they'll teach you how to play.
And don't forget Game Toppers with that cool new low table for content creators.
Oh, yeah. The Game Toppers booth's in that hall, and it's lovely. Like, their mats and tables are gorgeous, but the one thing that really caught our eye this year was they have these smaller, like, coffee table-style tables that they have. I think it's called the Lestrade. Sean's looking at it and he's like, I could use this for photography, because you can the lights and be able to go down over it. But it was just also one of their lovely tables with the wooden edges and everything. So that caught our eye. Queen Games has all their play to win is in always in that in that hall as well, because they always do play to win games. A lot of the tournaments, like I know All Play was having tournaments at Kabuto Sumo and stuff. They're in that area. So most of the competitive board gaming is sort of in that area.
Yeah, the ticketed events. If you bought a ticket to play a board game at the con, it was generally in that hall, not in the exhibit hall. In the exhibit hall, you could do demos, and a couple places did have a couple ticketed events. But in general, the gaming hall is where you would find all of that if you expect to sit down and play a full game.
And while there weren't a lot of CCGs and TCG tournaments, what there were are also in that hall.
Yep, that's correct. Which I know previous years was actually a separate room, a separate hall. So wandering the hall, we did check out a lot of cool looking war games and miniature games, people being set up, setting up their games. There are certain games that we see every year that I'm always happy to see. There's a fantasy game for kids featuring the Smurfs. And there's this one airship game that some year I'm going to go to Origins and play in. And it has these hanging airships. The Brown Castle Crokinole table area is always amazing. They had some really nice tables in there. We actually spent some time talking to Travis from Queen Games that first day, checking out what they have going on. And then it was kind of funny because we spent way more time than I ever would have expected in a single booth for a miniature game. And that was Rumble Slam. This is a fantasy wrestling game. So think like, you know, Blood Bowl with your fantasy races, but it's wrestling. And it's a miniature skirmish game where each player brings their own team of wrestlers and battles it out in a squared circle. And the squared circle in this case were these neoprene mats, and you can get different things. Or they had a very cool wooden ring that was actually also an organizer and case. That was just awesome. And the minis looked awesome. Like I was just like drooling over their shelf of like star players. I can't remember what features. I forget what they called them. But like just really cool looking miniatures.
Yeah, I have to say I'm not big on skirmish games, but I did dig the look of the minis. When we stopped by Queen, Travis was sitting there punching out games, furiously punching out games to get them ready to put them out for folks to play. And we stopped by and chatted with him for a while, and he was telling us about the expansion for Marrakesh, which is Camels and Nomads. And I have to say that sounded pretty cool, because you get a new types of Keshis, a camel racing thing going on. I want to check that one out at some point. But yeah, I derailed it. You were talking about wrestling.
It's all good.
And we do need a bigger table if we're going to be adding anything onto Marrakesh. Rumble Slam looked fantastic. It was a visually stunning game. But once we got to talking about it, it turned out to be a little on the disappointing side.
Yeah, what really turned me off is I asked one question and I said, so how's the campaign play work? Are there like leagues? Can I hire new wrestlers and improve my roster? And they're like, nope, none of that. And like they seem to be proud of it. Like, nope, we don't have any of that nonsense. Every game's one and done. You bring your wrestlers, you battle someone else's wrestlers, you figure out who won, and you're done. Next match, bring the same wrestlers or bring new ones, and one and done, and you're done. Now, they did have some expansions that included awesome things like ladder matches and table matches, which is awesome. But there was no progression. And honestly, that's what I feel a game like that needs. I need the Blood Bowl, right? I need the league, and I need my players getting injured and being off the field for a couple games and hiring star players and all that. And I got to say, Rumble Slam people, if you had had that, you might have had a sale to that day, because if it just had that touch, I would have been very interested in it.
I will say, I thought the card box that doubled as a wrestling ring was very cool. That's actually what I pulled you over to come look at it based on that, because I was like, check this out.
And sure, anyone can home rule it and you can build your own leagues and do all that stuff. But the ability to do that built into the game is so much more interesting and inviting, especially when you get into things like injuries or cheerleaders or whatever. Again, it's a beautiful game. The expansions they had added all sorts of in-ring content. They had, ladders and tables to smash through and all sorts of fun stuff. And again, it added to the beauty of the game. But if it's just playing the same match over and over again, even if it's in a different location, that's a hard sell.
I will jump back to Queen. Sorry if we're going to jump around a bit, but we're somewhat unscripted tonight, except for some bullet points. The one thing I will note about Queen, this is very important. Marrakesh, Camels, and Nomads is fully compatible with all editions of Marrakesh. It includes all the caches you need to add it to your Classic or Deluxe edition, or it has the cardboard tokens if you own Essential. So I actually props to Queen for doing that, because they could have put out two different versions, or they could have just said, oh, we're just putting it out for Essentials, but then I'd be playing my cool version without. So I thought that was awesome that it is fully compatible with all three SKUs there are now for the game.
So our next big thing was the media preview event, which had over 40 publishers and designers showing off their hotness to Gamma members like us. This year, all the Gamma members were invited, not just media, and it was a very busy area because of that. They probably could have spread things out a little more. They were using the speed puzzle area. So the tables were set up for that, and they just brought the game publishers in to lay out on that area. But a little, if they'd spread the tables out a little bit more, it would have been a lot more comfortable with all the people they were packing in there.
Yeah, and there was some confusion on the fact that it was also supposed to be open game night for the retailers, but no one seemed to know that, and no one seemed to bring any games. So there were all these tables at the back for open gaming that people were supposed to sit down and play stuff. And unfortunately, somewhere the message got lost. So it was like everything got shoved up in the front where it looked like there was tons of room, but they were expecting you to use that room to play games. So a little bit of miscommunication there. But honestly, it's still a cool event for us to get to see. We checked out a lot of games. Going to go through some highlights. I'm going to say the one of the first that caught my eye was a game called Sage Stones. And this is an abstract area control game that just looks like a classic game. Like, I don't know what you compare it to, like maybe a Moncala board or like a nice cribbage board. But it was these like beautiful wooden heirloom quality boards with these columns and squares on them that featured, like, they had one with Celtic artwork. They had one with Native artwork. And I'm like, oh my God, these are beautiful, like absolutely beautiful. Unfortunately, I didn't try a full game, but I got an overview and it sounded pretty solid. It had some elements of Moncala, some elements of Go. And like I said, it was just that leave it out on your coffee table or actually hang it on your wall, bring it out to play on special occasions. Makes me a reminder of my parents' house in the 70s with all wood furniture. There was just something about it that just, I'm like, this is cool. I like this.
Yeah, the thing with the media first look is it's 2 hours long and there are 40 publishers. And I mean, they said there was 40, but I know a few weren't actually there. So a little bit shy of 40 publishers. We saw a lot of games in 2 hours, a lot. It was like, look at this one for 1 minute and this one over here.
Yeah, it's a tough one. And also the interesting thing, the extra interesting thing about Sage Stones, not only did they have these beautiful heirloom boards, which featured on the back the rules for the entire rules for the game. So you didn't need a separate rule book. All you needed was that board. But they also had these wonderful portable versions that rolled up into a little scroll and everything you needed was carried in a tiny little scroll pouch. So they, you know, they had something for all, everyone who wanted to play the game portably or decoratively.
I have to say that rolled up version, it made me think that was something that people from like Society for Creative Anachronism would have. It looked like something you'd be porting around for ska.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the things that really caught my attention during that first look, and I know you guys had already seen it, so it wasn't new to you, but Metro Runner. Just looked fantastic. That game really kind of jumps out at you. As I was going through some photos earlier today, even just in my photos, I'm like, oh, that game just looks cool.
I am super excited about that one. The way that they handle net running, I think is the neatest I've ever seen.
Yeah, and we did bring a review copy of that one home. So you'll get to hear more about Metro Runner as we explore it. I'm going to call it a couple others because Metro Runners is one we did get to see at Gamma Expo. So a couple others we saw, and it to me is fascinating, and I've been sharing these on our Instagram lately, is the change in a game since Gamma Expo. So like I got to look at Boop the Halls and it just looks a lot better. It's no longer the old meeples with cardboard indies like stuck to them and the board's not made out of paper. It's looking a lot closer to finished. And then Hi-Fi, holy cow, is Hi-Fi looking good. Check out our reel where we've got the owner of Smirk and Dagger kind of giving you an overview on that game. And then Dicey Devices is looking better. And again, these are all things we saw at Gamma that just look even better now.
Yeah, I remember checking out a prototype copy of Dicey Devices at last year's media first look, and the game caught my attention again. Like, there's just something about it that I walk by and I go, oh, that one. But unfortunately, that's still not quite in production. I think it's going to Kickstarter soon.
Yeah, it's interesting how many of these games, sort of keep coming back. They're at first look in 2023. They're at first look in 2024. Yeah. As the publishers slowly work and mold them into a final form or nearly final form before they go on to Kickstarter, where they eventually hit their final form. And again, that's... As fans of our show know, we are less and less interested in that pre-Kickstarter content, but it is still interesting to see the games and just keep a foot of what is coming out in the future that we will possibly get our hands on at that point.
Now, another one we saw at Gamma Expo, but didn't actually get to learn much about, was Sears Catalog. As in, like, you know, you go shopping at Christmas in the Sears Catalog, but this is spelled Sears, like as in Mystics, S-E-E-R-S. And we checked out a brand new game we didn't see at Gamma Expo called Rebel Princesses. Now, this is Bezier, and I am hyped for Rebel Princesses because it's an evolution of Hearts. And Hearts is my all-time favorite traditional card game. It is the one, if you want to sit down, like, do you want to play Euchre? Nah, poker? Nah, spades? Yeah, maybe. Hearts? Oh, hell yeah. Let's sit down. And I got to say, it looked fantastic. And Sears Catalog also looked good. It's a trick bidding game where it's one of those games where you have to bid for tricks with a kind of cool theme of Mystics going shopping.
Yeah, I really like the look of both of those games, but Sears Catalog was already on my radar. It's why I went over to the table, was because I wanted to ask for an overview of it and get the actual rules, because I had just looked at it briefly at Gamma Expo, and it looks solid. But The Rebel Princess, which is a deluxe edition. It's a newer edition that now has two new princesses and stuff. I didn't even know that game existed. It wasn't something I was aware of at all. And I have to say, normally the princess theme would completely turn me off. But this is a game where the winning princess is the one that manages to escape all the suitors. Yes. And the artwork is really lovely. And there are a few princess characters included beyond the usual Disney princesses. So it checked off all the boxes for me. And plus, like Mo said, the whole hearts thing. Yeah, it just looks like a really great game.
Yeah, the Rebel Princesses definitely looked strong. And I'm looking forward to seeing that one develop and get out there. The art on it and the play style of it, as well as the theme, just really kind of.
Next, took a look at Estate. This is a game that we got pitched to review just before the con. And I actually told them, you know what, if you're going to be at Origins, I'll come by and check it out at the con and then we'll make a decision. And all I'll say is, after looking at it is we said yes.
Yeah, I basically told Mo, okay, we're going to review this one. I like the look of it. So that's something you'll be seeing later this year.
Well, tune in and keep in touch to find out when that one is going to hit our tables.
So Volca is a new card game from Terrible Games with fantastic art. We got an overview from the owner of Terrible Games, John DeCampos, later in the show, and learned they sold out by the end of it. So congratulations, John and Brooke, on doing so well at your first Origins.
Yeah, the art style on that game, it's kind of unique. It's got a real Dungeon Crawl classic kind of vibe to it. Something about this one didn't appeal to me, but I liked the look of the art and stuff, and I could get why it caught your attention, Mo.
Yeah, totally makes sense, right?
Yeah, I have to say,
I totally get it.
The art on this one doesn't do anything for me, so I'm interested to see what the gameplay does and whether or not that sort of distracts me from the art, which isn't bad. It's just not something that really caught my eye.
Yeah, so this is a dueling card game, but it's one for up to five players. There are two types of units, which are, I think it was spells, action and bluff cards, and then you had your characters. And you're doing rows. So it had to do with battle lines, like front and back rows, and certain things only affected the front and back. For a dueling card game, it seemed pretty solid. And I think the big drive was they were sick of two-player games, and they wanted something your whole game group could play. Now, another one that caught our eye is Floristry. This is a new abstract, flower-themed, domino-based area majority game from David Gordon and Tam. This one's coming next year from Uncommons Publishing. This just looked amazing. Had a great tactile quality with like wooden frame that you were working in and small wooden dominoes with different flowers on them. It just looked beautiful. It was just very eye-catching.
Almost Azul-like look to it because of the little domino tiles. I don't know, something just had a super appealing table presence. Then I saw there was an app involved and some sort of real-time timer sort of aspect, and that scared me away. But then I discovered that it's actually more about playing chicken versus your opponent. You got your finger, you're going to sit there, you're going to see who taps first, to see who will bid first in the Dutch auction. As the price goes down, the longer you wait, but you want to try and bid before your opponent. And it's strictly two players, and it actually looks pretty neat.
Yeah, it's always nice, I find, to say, see, nowadays when a game says, I am a two-player game. I'm not a one- to three-player game that is best at two. No, I am a two-player game. It's rare, but it's a powerful statement when they say, no, we know what we do best, and that's all we're going to do. So it'll be interesting to see how the app works out and how that real-time aspect, even if it is a little different than some other real-time aspects, plays out and how well it sits with us and Deanna and her fear of real-time games.
So I got to say, we don't have this one. This one's far away from being complete. This was a very early prototype. So you won't get to hear our thoughts on it until the next Origins, possibly. Now, one thing to note, they did call this the first ever real-time Dutch auction in a board game, which is probably a true thing because you need the app to do that, I guess. So I guess you could have another player on the side counting down. I don't know. Next up, Zev from Play to Z Games or Zed Games, depending on which country you're from, walked us through Lynx and King's Coalition. Lynx is a fascinating stock market game based on the Hudson Bay Company and pelt trading in northern Canada. And King's Coalition, we were told, was a similar game to Fantasy Realms, which I've never played, so I can't actually compare the two. What this is a hand management, hand building card game all about collecting sets of cards based on some random scoring cards that come out both at the beginning of the game and are revealed as you're playing. This one was good enough that we took a review copy home. This is going to be a hit.
Yeah, we played a full demo game of King's Coalition, and I was completely sold on that one. What I liked was the way the endgame scoring cards were revealed each round, and you kept having to adjust your plans mm-hmm. based on that. I liked that mechanic. And Lynx looks neat. I love the HBC Trapper theming. It's set in Ontario, so can't go wrong there. But there's some interesting mechanics to simulate an ecosystem where you need to keep the lynx and the hare populations in balance while also trying to collect the most pelts and sell them at the best price. So there's some cool stuff going on there. We just had an overview. We didn't play it, but I was intrigued with the game.
Yeah, auction games aren't my thing. That's not a mechanic that I am drawn to. But this one, because of that additional ecosystem concept thrown in, really did intrigue me because I love the way that there was this multi-layer balance that was in play with the value and the populations of two different species all interlinked throughout the mm-hmm. game. And as well, the interesting thing was the game board, while you started at 0 points, it allowed you to go all the way to negative 50 points because you needed to go into debt to buy what you needed in order to get your trading started. Yep. So there was a really interesting go low before you succeed start aspect to that game.
And I think that aspect's probably going to make it appeal to fans of Brass and some of the rail games like Age of Steam, where you often have to take out loans to be able to get moving, to be able to make your economy work, to be able to make money by the end of the game. Now, Panda Royale looks like a simple dice-based roll and write that when you look at it, it's like, oh, it's like Quicks with a bunch of different dice. But that is not at all what it is. It's actually like a dice pool building game. It's a dice drafting game where the color of the dice you draft each round do different things. Some of the dice you draft are going to help you draft first so you can get the better picks later. Others are going to let you draft more dice on your turn. There are some dice that let you steal dice from other players. And then there's some really good, the red dice in particular, can make you a ton of points because you multiply your number of red dice by the total on your dice. But half the values on them are negative, so they're a huge risk. This is a lot more of an engine builder than most roll and writes I play. And that's why I made sure to get a review copy before the end of the con.
I had zero interest in this game. None. Like, I kept walking by the table and going, nope, nope, not for me. And Mo grabbed me and made me sit down and play a demo game. And it wasn't the game I thought it was going to be. Like, sure, it's dice, tons of dice, and random as all heck. But there's actually a fair bit of strategy. And like Mo said, it's an engine builder where you're building your dice pool and getting it stolen from you and taking from other people and all that stuff. The sheer number and the variety of dice give the game some table presence because it actually looks pretty neat. You're like, what the heck's going on over there? I think it's going to be a neat game to bring out to public play events. I would rather be playing something meatier in general, but I think for that pub setting, this is going to be bang on.
Yeah, it's interesting. One of the big features of this game is that it plays from 3 to 10 players. And again, that is another one of those fantastic sort of games for those game night event type.
Now, I don't want to belittle the games we didn't talk about. There were a bunch of other very cool things in the media first look, but those are the ones that stuck out to us. And we don't want to be here all night just talking about day one. So we spent the rest of the evening exploring the gaming hall. And on the way out of the convention center, on our way out to dinner, I got lured by space cheese. There were giant barrels that said space cheese on them. And between these barrels was a door, and we walked in and discovered Starship Horizons Bridge Simulator. We talked to the employees who were there. They weren't running an event right now. They were actually still setting up. But we got to explain that it was basically a unofficial Star Trek Bridge Simulator game made by people who loved Artemis but found it too video game-like. Whereas this is more of the bridge interacting with people and going on missions and more of a bridge crew experience than flying around and just shooting things and clicking on sensors. Now, it also had some of the true dungeon thing going on where when you went through it the first time, you would get cards. So the next time you go through, you could use the cards to unlock power-ups and other things. From what I understood, there were like secret missions that you could unlock that you didn't get to try unless you showed up with the right cards and everything else. Now, unfortunately, we never actually managed to fit in a try. But from what I was hearing from others, it was a really good experience. Once they got through the tech issues, they had a little bit of a rough time getting going. So I've heard if you played it near the end of the con, it was a fantastic experience. And honestly, it's something I'm looking forward to seeing at future cons.
Yeah, for a random thing I didn't know was there, this intrigued me so much. And the setup looked pretty neat. Like it was dark in there and we kind of peered in and you could see all these monitors and a bridge crew setup. And I was like, that's pretty cool. The one thing they mentioned was that they were running the light version at Origins and the version at Gen Con is a little more robust on the tech side and that has live NPCs, which also intriguing.
Yeah, this is interesting. Unlike Artemis, you are actually standing up at your bridge consoles. I don't know if it's moving around between them, but there are no chairs. You're standing up with a large, you know, touchscreen monitor interface in front of you, as well as the giant bridge, you know, front monitor. And yeah, the person we were talking about actually plays an NPC during the full game when they have their entire crew of and technical things available to them. So I hope they had a great show, and we do look forward to.
So that was it for day one. We headed back to our Airbnb and got to bed early, actually, because Thursday was going to be the longest day of the con.
Origins Game Fair day two. Thursday.
Now, another benefit of being a Gamma Media member, actually, just again, retailers actually had this benefit as well, is we got early access to the exhibit hall. So we were in the line by 8:30 a.m., which is a little early for a con. We got in early, did a quick walk from end to end just to kind of get a general layout. I took a video of this, and I was totally planning on putting on like Instagram and Twitter or Facebook, but unfortunately, I guess it was too long because I couldn't actually upload it anywhere due to the size. So you may eventually get to see that if Deanna's willing to edit it down. I'm just bummed because I really wanted to share that initial walkthrough before anyone could see it, maybe get some people hyped about stuff, especially the people who are waiting outside to get in. But unfortunately, that didn't quite pay off.
Yeah, because it was over 5 minutes long. I think I could compress it. I don't know. I'd have to try. Yeah, so the doors opened for us at 9 a.m. and we lined up a little bit early and we did a really quick walk from one end of the hall to the other. Well, Mo recorded this video and we got a peek at everything we wanted to circle back to.
Yeah, it was interesting this year. Rather than just letting people accumulate in front of the doors, they actually set up proper, you know, queuing this time, which was nice, although it did confuse some people because there was apparently a premiere. You know, if you paid a whole bunch of money, you got to go in early or something, but that was different than the media members and retailers who got to go in early. So, again, could have been a little bit clearer on some of the messaging, but it did allow the publishers and exhibitors to get in easily without having to fight their way through the crowd of media members who were blocking the door.
Yeah, it was the premier badge, which replaced the VIG, which was very important, gamer. That was something new that replaced something old. I don't know the details, but basically they got in at the opposite end. We got in Hall A, they got in at the end of Hall B.
Nice. They had their badges mailed to them ahead of time.
Yep.
And they got priority hotel block. I think that was basically the gist of it.
I know they did not get a whole bunch of game swag because that was something that happened in the past that they didn't do for them. And that was why they changed the name because they didn't want people to think they were going to get a bunch of free games out of joining. But anyway, I love the video I took when I was walking around because I was like getting people to wave at us and everything. And I really wish it had turned out because I was like, you know, pointing at people and someone high fived us. That part would have been cool. But anyway, overall, I like the layout. They spread everything out and there were more, I don't know what to call it, crossways. Like there was more, the rows weren't as long without there being a crossing path. Like you probably could have done most of the hall going horizontally instead of vertically. I don't know if that makes sense. So I like that. Another thing I noticed is they did a much better job at grouping similar types of stuff. So all of the buy and sell trading card game booths were in one corner. And they were there, and that's what you were there to do, you knew where to go. And if that's what you weren't there to do, you could avoid it. And I love the way they put every miniature gaming related booth, from paints to minis to 3D printed models, all in a circle around the play to take area, which I thought was awesome. Now, there was some 3D printing stuff in other areas because I think of how they logged that they were like, we're RPG minis, so they were in a different spot. But I like that as well. In general, the major RPG publishers were kind of grouped in a certain area up near the front. Well, there were a lot of big name publishers who weren't in attendance, and we kept being shocked as the weekend went on. Like companies we've worked with in the past, we just expect to be at Gamma who weren't. What this did, though, is without those big, like you didn't have anyone huge. There was no Fantasy Flight, WotC, Asmodee, any of those massive companies there. But that meant there was more room for the smaller publishers, and the lower tiered companies ended up with a lot more space and space closer to the doors. And based on the publishers we know and talked to, this worked out really well for them.
There was tons of great board games there. With a few less of the big publishers there, I think people got more of a spotlight on the mid-tier ones, which was kind of neat. When Mo was talking earlier, he said the play and take area, he meant the paint and take area. Sorry. The miniature painting competition area had all the mini stuff in a circle around it, which was cool.
Now, I know there are a lot of people who were upset that there weren't a lot of big name players there. And I can understand that if you're going to a game con, you might want to get your, you know, the new hotness from Asmodee or whoever. But again, this really did allow a lot of the, smaller game manufacturers to get a lot of attention. What I think a lot of people were upset about or confused about is the number of dice. In particular, what you'll hear a lot of people talking about is the number of people selling dice. Now, there are a lot of them had some of the lower tier stuff that everyone had some of that. But there was also a lot of really nice, high end handcrafted stuff. I mean, there were literally sets of dice out there that were in the 4-digit price range. Mm-hmm. You could spend over $1,000 on dice if that was your thing. So it wasn't all just, you know, a whole bunch of different colored, pre-made dice, pre-made polyhedrals. There was some great stuff out there. But again, most of those booths also had, some generic dice as well. And that kind of skewed things and gave people, I think, a bit of a sour taste in their mouth for the number of dice out there.
But then we talked about this. How would Gamma deal with that? Did they go, oh, we're only going to allow 12 dice publishers in, and after that, we're done. No more dice people. I think there was 18 or 19 booths that were there to sell dice, mostly dice at least. And that's a lot out of the hall of 363.
I don't know. I find that one interesting just because how many different RPG publishers were there? How many different 3D printed models were there? How many different miniature booths? Like, if you're into dice, this was heaven for you. Yep. It's not my thing.
That's why I'm asking.
And I just don't see why you would blame Origins for this, because it's who applied to buy a booth, right?
Well, I'm not, like, and I don't think blaming Origins is the fact. I think the problem is, the people who are going to be able to get a spot ahead of a dice manufacturer are the tier one games who were not there. If Asmodee wants a booth, Asmodee is going to get a booth. If Asmodee isn't getting a booth and there are booths available, whoever applies is going to get one. And that's what I think the where people are seeing the problem is, for some reason, Origins is not attracting the tier one, the giant game manufacturers. Yep. And as a result of that, there are things that some people perceive as smaller or lower quality booths taking those spaces. And
my complaint wasn't smaller or lower quality. It was just that there was a lot of sameness with the dice. And it wasn't even my complaint. It was just a complaint I overheard from other people. And I'm just wondering if Gamma has, as the person, the body that organizes Origins, is it up to them to balance out the types of booths that are there or not? It's something I don't know.
It's an interesting discussion.
Debate go.
It's an interesting that might be another podcast topic for us to talk about another day, I think. Is what could Gamma do different at Origins or something like that? It is not what we're talking about tonight. The first super hot game, like super people were going bonkers for it, was Ito from Arcane Wonders. The moment the doors opened at 9, there was a lineup at their booth. When I was doing my walkthrough, I'm like, okay, no other booth has a lineup. They have a lineup. When we came back from the walkthrough, there was still a lineup. I'm like, all right, I got to know what's going on. So I literally walked up to the line. I said, hey, everyone, I'm Motus on the Tabletop Bellhop. What are you all in line for? And some people are like, to buy games. And then someone got it and like, oh, Ito. I took a picture right then. And it's like 9:05, right? Maybe 9:20 by the time I got there, somewhere in there. And they have like one Kallax full of this game and it's already half gone. Now, I hadn't heard about this game. I didn't hear the hype for this one. I guess it's a super popular trick-taking game from Japan or some card game from Japan that Arcane Wonders is localizing. And it was just released for the first time at the show. And they, as far as I know, were actually sold out before the hall officially opened. The Premier Gamers and the retailers that were Gamma members got all the copies.
So, it was actually an ordering game. You think of it like, the Mind or those other games where you're just trying to put cards in order. But it is 2 to 8 players and does some interesting things. It's not a new game at all. It was released in Japan in 2019 or 2018. And there is actually a new version of it. Ito Rainbow, Arclight Games is the publisher, is the primary publisher. But again, it's being localized by others.
I have to say that made me super curious to check it out. Yep. And while we were there chatting with the booth rep, people were just coming up and they were reaching around us to grab Ito. And they'd be like, can I help you? Ito. They just like someone else walk up. Yep. And go, Ito.
Now, to answer a quick question from our chat room, which is an important one. Yes, there were multiple sets of Braille dice available at the con. I saw them in metal. I saw them in plastic. One of those 4-digit sets of dice were some really nice metal Braille dice. They were, I would almost say, common. I couldn't tell you if they were at all 19 booths, but I definitely did run into multiple sets of Braille dice, often on display out the front. And that's going to lead me to bring up something else that we don't have in our show notes, but I want to bring up about Origins is, oh my God, I love how accessible and I'm drawing a blank on the word.
Diverse.
Accepting and open and yes, diverse the crowd was, willing to accept diversity. This was one of the most diverse events I have ever gone to, where there were people of all color. Accommodating was the word I was looking for. Thank you, Ryan. Just accepting place, like safe space. The variety of people that we saw and how well treated everything was. Now, I will admit, maybe there were things we didn't see behind the scenes. I haven't personally seen any complaints, but this is one of the most diverse cons I've ever been to. And Origins is awesome for it. And that goes not just for the attendees, but the booth volunteers, the publishers that were there. It was just awesome to see so many gamers.
Yeah, I hope there are people who we'll speak out if there were problems. Again, yeah. You never know. Many people are unfortunately far too used to negative treatment and stay quiet about it because it's just their norm. So I really do hope that people do speak out if there were negative experiences had, so that Gamma can focus on those and deal mm-hmm. with them appropriately. Because again, everywhere I went, and we did split up a lot during this show, so we were in different areas a lot of the time. And again, like Mo, I did not see any negative experiences appearing in my travels of the show.
There's just more and more not just men at these cons. That's something I noticed. And also, I actually didn't have a negative experience that hinged on the fact that I'm not a man. So, and that's a first. So that was cool too. There was one guy that was like walked up to me and his conversation opener was, "You're smiling. You look really happy. Most women don't look happy in places like this." And I was like, yeah, this is my happy place. I'm good here. And but the conversation got better from there. It was just a really bad opening.
Yeah, that one was a bit awkward. You told me about that. We have experienced much worse. And I will say, even publishers and booth people that when we walked up didn't just look to me, right? Like mm-hmm. to start true. The conversation. So that like I said, it was just awesome. Like ridiculously diverse compared to other cons I've been to. And
yeah, I think the one negative experience I did see, and I will say there was one, when we were exploring the Catalyst booth later in the show and we were walking by the BattleTech events, the big giant mm-hmm. battles. We did see one father and daughter duo, and that daughter did not look like that was the experience she had been looking for from a game con.
Who knows? We came by in a 5-minute segment. I will say that child looked miserable.
Yes, they looked miserable. But that was also the second last day of the con, and who knows?
I might have looked miserable at times on Sunday.
They could
too,
have been, they might have had a mech failure. There could have been a bad roll that shortly. Who knows? That was the one negative experience that I witnessed from the show.
One of our first stops once the hall opened was the Foam Brain Games booth, which is one of those dice booths, to be fair. They also have pins and lots of other awesome things. We actually really like Foam Brain. They had a claw machine where you could win dice if you got the claw machine to work. And the way this was tied in is if you ate at Barley's, which I just talked about in our coffee break there, that if you ate at Barley's at any time during the con, you could bring your menu to the booth and get a free pull. And of course, being a claw machine, no, we had three attempts and did not really get any close.
I set it up really well for somebody else, though, I think.
Homebrain has, like, one of their new things that they had out since last Origins was they're doing little charms, like charm bracelet charms, or you can use them for whatever, that are gamer themed. And they're so cool. I just want them for no good reason. They're a little green meeple. I could have a little green meeple charm and a little mimic charm. I really wanted to waste money on that. They're only $8 a piece, but I was trying to be frugal. But we did not get free dice. Still, I thought the claw machine was a cool thing for them to offer. And I took a video of the guys trying to use it. And like I said, Sean got pretty close. I think he definitely set it up so that the next person coming along was going to have a way better chance at that red set than I.
The next game that caught our eye was Power Well. This looks a bit like Potion Explosion because it's got this like big acrylic well that has a floodgate at the bottom and then three channels where marbles come out in different colors. And this felt like a board game version of Puzzle Quest, any of the versions of Puzzle Quest to have existed going back to the Nintendo DS days. I love Puzzle Quest. I'm obsessed with it. I still play Marvel Puzzle Quest. So this is one where you're going to make matches of the marbles and take them off the set to set off your powers. The power system felt very much like Dice Throne. So instead of rolling dice and using dice patterns to set off your attacks and stuff, you're instead pulling off things. And like you didn't need it wasn't match three. Like you could pull off just one blue and do something minor, but like to get the good powers off, you had to grab four of a kind. Really liked the art and the quality of this. And I was really hyped about this until we're like, hey, how can we help you promote this? Right. And they're like, well, we're going to launch on crowdfunding sometime, maybe next year, maybe the year after. That was odd. I was like hyped about this and it looked great, but like, that's far out. Like, I'm shocked that they were even at Origins this early.
So, for one thing, I will say the game looked polished.
Yeah.
At a quick look, you did not think that this was a prototype. It looked like a complete game. They as they were describing it to us, and you're like, oh, wouldn't it be cool? They're like, yeah, we've thought about doing this, and we're still tinkering with that. So, obviously, the rules were in a little bit of flux still. But I was floored when they said, yeah, this should be going to Kickstarter in 2026. I'm like, what are you doing here at Origins? Yeah. That's a lot of money to be standing there and not selling a game. I hope that they got lots of great feedback over the weekend. They did have a neat looking thing going on.
Yeah, and they aren't even on Board Game Geek yet, so they haven't even reached that point yet. So it's an interesting choice, but we do wish them well, and we did hear other people talking about this game as well. It caught a lot of people's attention, even though it was off on a far corner of the floor.
And what was interesting is that was our first experience with it, but this was not the only booth with nothing to sell and no active crowdfunding projects, nor one even coming that year. There were a lot of people there just trying to generate initial buzz for projects that were up to 3 years off. And I got to say, that gave the entire hall kind of a unique feel to previous years when we've gone. Now, last year, there were a lot of published games, but there was a lot of, we're live right now on Kickstarter, back our game now. This was like, yeah, we're going to kickstart later, which just, it was odd. And it kind of reminded me of the dice thing. I think, again, because some of the big names weren't there, there was space for these smaller people to be able to get in with their booths and be able to show off their thing. Now, I did see some comments on Facebook groups and stuff that kind of said, don't waste your money on that. Like, just go to the Unpub area because that's what it's for. And you don't pay thousands of dollars to show off your games in Unpub. But, you know, to each their own. Like, if it worked for them, great.
Yeah, the amount of check out my prototype was definitely up. And I just thought it was weird. It wasn't bad, just weird. And it happened more than once where I was like, tell me about this game. This looks pretty good. Okay. And is this, can I get this now at the show? And they're like, yeah, we think first quarter of next year we're going to be on Kickstarter. And I'm like, okay.
It's an interesting dynamic. I would love to hear from some of these publishers how the show went for them, what they got out of that show. And if they found it was worth the price of a booth, which we know aren't cheap.
See, I'm going to say I sat through a seminar at Gamma Expo with Gwen Ruel from Runaway Parade And she talked about how they have the Fire Tower game and how taking that leap to get a booth at a pricier con, I think for them it was Gen Con, was one of the big things that made their game successful. And having people come and pre-play and demo your game and liking it enough to get on your email list means that when you launch, you're launching to people that are already interested. So, I mean, maybe there is a value there for it, but it was weird as heck to me.
Hey, if any of you are listening, hit us up. Let us know how it went. If you were an indie publisher who was at Origin showing off your game for the first time that was, you know, a prototype or not going to kickstart for a year or so, we would love to hear how it worked out. Now, I was pleased to see all games terrain at Origins again. It ends up last time. We talked about this on our last Origins recap because I thought it was so neat. It ends up that was their first show and this is their second. And I guess their company has really blew up, which is awesome. This new brand, All Games Terrain, is a huge hit. Now, what people may not realize is this is just Woodland Scenics. Like the people who have been making game terrain for model kits and stuff like that for years. And the thing was, is there was kind of a stigma of, oh, that's the train people. Those are the people for the model kits. Those are the HO scenery. That's not for gamers. So they decided to launch a branding of All Games Terrain. And I guess it went fantastic. So that's great to hear. And this is one of those booths you just have to check out because it's a fun thing you can do for free is you can go to their booth and make your own full piece of scenery, a little, you know, diorama like Plinth. And it's also something you can even combine with the paint and take. So you go paint and take your mini, and then you can put it on the plinth at the end, which is just pretty awesome.
Yeah, you end up with a sizable little piece that if you, depending on how you created it, would be just great for popping a mini on the middle of it. And it's right next to I thought it was brilliant that this year it was right next to the paint and take.
Yeah, they're a great, they seem to be a great company, really interested and interactive, fun to deal with. And we had some really nice chat with them.
Now, speaking of minis, there were some fantastic tables from Cincinnati Arsenal Gaming and a charity called Sanctuary at Homestead, which is a nonprofit whose goal is to make gaming more accessible to everyone. And I gotta say, like, just their tables were amazing. They had a Fallout table where it recreated one of the first cities from Fallout 3, like, perfectly. And personally, I got all excited because there was a game of Warhammer, the Old World, set up that brought back some memories and, of course, the desire to pick up painting yet again.
Yeah, their minis.
Now, the first game.
Their mini setups were gorgeous. They had some fantastic paints. It was really hard not to walk by their areas and get that urge to, oh, I want to have a battle. Whether you liked 40K yep. or Old School or Age of Sigmar, it was all there to catch your eye.
Yep. Now, the first game we actually played at the con. This is the first game Deanna and I sat down, played almost a full game of Blueprints of Mad King Ludwig, which was fantastic. Now, we first got to see this flip and write game at Gamma Expo, and we already were kind of hyped about it, and we talked about it a lot last time. But getting to play it, I now need this game. I need a copy in my collection. Sadly, we weren't able to bring a review copy out because, good for Bezier, they sold out. They were sold out by Sunday when we stopped by their booth. If you are a Castles of Mad King Ludwig fan, you need to try this game. You get all the room building fun and all the building of the castle, but in a much, much shorter time frame without the biggest thing, no setup, no sorting the tiles and filling out the tiles and shuffling the goals and all that stuff. Actually, there are still gold tiles, so I guess there's a little bit of it. But just like it just you just play. You just shuffle some cards and play. And there's still a ton of depth to this game. And the big change from the core game is when you close off a room, you mark it off as completed. Well, you can choose to use the ability from that room anytime on a future turn by kind of like marking off a little flag. And that adds a ton of depth to the game on trying to figure out when to use your room powers.
There's one that has to go off right away. And I'm thinking,
yeah, there's one where you get an extra turn.
Yeah. But so, you know, you want to be careful when you close that one off. But the rest of it, you could delay and wait until you wanted to set the powers off. This game is so cool. Like, if you like Castles of Mad King Ludwig, just go get this game. We're done. It like most of it makes it tighter, less fiddlier. The cleanup and the setup is just, you know, play. I loved it. I wanted to play it again as soon as I was done. I was sad that we played a shortened demo game because I just wanted to keep running with it. I understand why they sold out, but I was super bummed they sold out. I wanted a copy so bad.
Yeah, I think one of the nice features about this game is, again, it's another one of those games where you don't have to be the artist because the vellum sheets are semi-transparent. So you just slide that card underneath, position it exactly how you want it laid out in your blueprint, and then trace over top.
And, you know, I thought that was kind of a silly gimmick at first, but some of the room shapes are pretty weird, and it would be hard to just eyeball it and get it accurate. But with the vellum and the tracing paper, right? Like, you just do-do-do.
Yeah, and it was good because you had all the flipped sides of the shape. Like every card had the room, and then the room flipped. So it was really good for just, like, moving around to position stuff to see if it worked as well, which was something nice. Like, without that, you'd be like, oh, I think this fits, and then start drawing it and mess it up. Like, it was a more of a key part of the game than I thought it would be. All right, next up, the three of us had a memorable meeting with Sean from Kids Table Board Games and Burnt Island Games. We got to try out their latest, well, I shouldn't say latest game, a game they are currently working on called Layers. This is a two-player only dungeon building game where each player builds a dungeon map behind their screen with some really cool components. Then players explore each other's maps, kind of using like a battleship system where you're like, I move to B3, and they're like, oh, I see a wall to the north. And then I use my sheet and I draw on the wall to the north. And I'm like, okay, I moved to B4. Like, well, you see a wall to the east and south, and oh no, you've stumbled into a trap. It was really enjoyable, really fun. Building the dungeon was fun. The rules for building the dungeon were simple enough that we kind of got it on the first time. There's some rules about like every path has to only go past one monster. There has to be a way. It was really neat. That was a very cool game.
It's KTBG, so it's designed to be family weight, and it felt like it would be great to play with kids. It's strictly a two-player game. It was super fun. I took a short reel and popped that up on Instagram that you can go look for, where you can see what some of the components look like and stuff. But like, unfortunately for me, what was most memorable about that was that I had brought a glass coffee thermos with me in my purse, and I hadn't used it all morning. And I sat down at the table on the one side, and then the rep we were talking to, Sean, said, come around, sit down at the other side of the table, and we can both play. You and Mo can play Layers. I'll show you how to play it. Yep. And I went, why is my skirt wet? Oh, my whole purse is wet. Oh, my coffee thing must be leaking. So I took it out thinking I would just adjust the lid. And when I took it out, the bottom fell out of this dual-walled glass thing. The bottom went down, the rest of it went up. Glass and coffee exploded everywhere. And I was like, it was mortifying because like I exploded glass and coffee all over their booth, and my purse was full of glass and it was leaking coffee, and it ruined all of our papers and business cards that we brought with us. And then after that, my brain was just like, I was so thrown off that the rep from Kids Table Board Gaming, Sean, explained the game to me, and then I went to play and I'm like, I think I got maybe 90% of that. Let's see what happens. I was like, my brain is not in the game right now. I'm thinking, oh my gosh, there's still glass on the floor. Yeah, so that was one of the most memorable moments of the con for me. No more coffee in my purse ever. No more glass thermoses ever. Yeah,
this is a really interesting game. It's sort of Battleship the Dungeon Crawl. And it's really interesting for that. The one potential pitfall I saw in it is, especially if you're playing with kids, because you're not allowed to see the other person's dungeon, you won't know if a mistake has been made in the formation of the dungeon until you run into that. So I think as a family game, if you are going to be playing it with an adult and a child, you might want to have a third person just as a sort of referee, do a quick glance at the dungeons before, because anyone can make a mistake. It's really, it's easy to do, but it's also easy to just put that one wall in the wrong spot and, oh, I accidentally closed off this area, even though I didn't mean to.
Yeah, I think if you're playing with younger kids, a third person that was reffing would be super helpful.
Yeah, it's definitely more than just Battleship, because it's got this interesting cube-based action management system where you're sitting there and spending cubes to do things. And like, you spend a white cube to creep and you move one square. You could spend two white cubes to, I think it was rush or run. And then there were also special colored cubes where you could just spend a yellow cube to rush. And that was kind of neat. So it's not just, you know, what's at D6, right? There was more to it than that. The other thing that really drew me in was once Sean showed us Box 2, which let us know that there is a legacy style campaign where after each game, you unlock a box with new rules. Now, this included like new skills for your characters, for new things you could do besides creep and run, new monsters and other things you could put in your dungeon. Now, my problem with this game is I was hyped for this, and it's in like early prototyping. This is a super early prototyping, and this one's not coming out for a while now. So don't go looking for this one at Gen Con, though from what I understand, Sean will be there showing it off. So if you can do a demo or get to see it, do it, but you won't be able to pick this up this year.
I could be wrong. I think they plan on putting it in a Kickstarter in the latter half of this year. It is up on their website with a little splash page saying it's coming to Kickstarter in late 2024. So,
oh yeah.
To be honest, my composure was so lost after the coffee thing. I know he gave us this information. I feel bad I didn't write it down like I normally would, and I'm not sure exactly when it's launching. One of the cool things about the cube actions, one of the actions you could do was backtrack. And it let you just for, I think it was 2 cubes, and most things either cost 1 or 2 cubes, go all the way back through parts of the dungeon you'd already been through. And that really helped with the flow of the game, because if you go all the way down here and end up in a dead end, and then you got to spend 4 turns going all the way back, that just drags, right? So the backtrack zipped things up, and I thought it made it flow really smoothly.
All right, next, we stop by the Wise Wizard booth. I shouldn't necessarily say next, because we probably wandered around the hall and looked at some dice and checked out some other things. But the next notable thing we did was stop by the Wise Wizard booth and chatted with Danielle, who is the co-designer of Caution Signs, which was already doing really well for them. Now, we did at that time pick up review copies of the Robot Quest Arena expansions, as well as a copy of Caution Signs, which we actually ended up playing already at the con later that night.
We had done a demo game of, well, Mo played a demo game and I sat there and took photos of Caution Signs at Gamma Expo. So we were already completely sold on this idea, right? And yeah, we took home a copy, immediately opened it, and ended up playing it at our Bellhop meetup Thursday night. So it was super fun as you would imagine. I think we're going to talk about that later. And the Robot Quest Arena expansions, I think we mentioned when we were doing the review, it's what's cool about it is like this little expansion packs with cute robots, cute giant 3D robots, but it's also new rule sets for the game in each expansion pack. So I'm actually kind of excited to check those out.
Yeah, I was really excited about the Robot Arena expansions with not only new minis, new cubes, new cards, new tiles, new rules. Each one adds a whole lot to what is already a really fun game.
I spent some time in the Malifaux booth. I shouldn't say the Malifaux booth. I should say the Weird Games booth, who do Malifaux. They also do the hobo game, the hobo train game that I'm drawing a blank on the name of. Mainly, though, I was distracted by some Malifaux actual play that was going on with some amazing scenery and miniatures. And it was kind of cool because while I was over there scoping things out, a fan happened to be doing the demo and looked up and caught my eye and started talking to them for quite a bit. So that was pretty cool. I invited them out to our get together that night and they actually came. So that was pretty cool. If I was still into painting minis and skirmish games, I so would be very tempted to get into this game. It just looks amazing. The other thing they were doing were demos of the game, and it's Vagrant Song is the name of it, which is like a Cthulhu mythos hobos on a train game that just looks really cool. Unfortunately, those were all ticketed events, and we didn't know our schedule well enough to get tickets to actually try it.
I meant to come back later and demo Vagrant Song. I'm super curious about that game. I think the only reason I'm hesitant to review it is because it is a campaign game, and I know it'll take us a long time to get it played enough to review, but otherwise, I'm like so drawn to it. I went and spent some time in the Restoration Games booth, and I was just like stalking the Dark Tower table. I spent at least half an hour just standing there watching the guy demo it to 2 different groups. Like, I am super entranced by this game. I'm like, I'm just going to look over his shoulder and check out what's going on the iPad. Okay, that's pretty cool. And I'm going to look at the minis over here. And yeah, like I'm still, I really want to play that game.
Yeah, no, and that Vagrant Song game looks so great. It's a 30-plus hour campaign where you're a vagrant on a haunted train trying to figure out what's going on and dealing with ghosts. Yeah, it was fantastic. And during this time, this was Thursday, so Thursday I would have been, I don't even know where I was. I was probably hanging out over with, some cosplayers at that time, first doing my first look at the fantastic cosplay area, sponsored by Rubber City Cosplay, who's hosting the cosplay area and the cosplay competition for Origins now, 2 years in a row.
Now, I got to say, the one thing that they did again this year that I really liked is they have this cosplay tavern area. And due to the way they laid out the game hall, there used to be a thing where if you got to the end of a row to the back of the hall, there were some chairs set up back there and some seating and a couple restaurants that were open. So it was a place to eat, and it was a great place to sit down and rest your feet. It was like, for those of us on the heavier side, it was kind of like the reward for finishing a row. Instead, there was still this cosplay tavern with these big round tables. So it was one of the few places you could actually just like chill and hang out and sit.
Yeah, it was interesting though, because there was so much gaming going on, they actually co-opted the cosplay tavern area for the Wingspan tournament that they were holding because they didn't have enough other tables available. So that did limit a little bit of the seating area over there. But thankfully or not, the Wingspan tournament wasn't as popular as the number of tables they had there. So there was always a little bit of space.
Now, one of the things you do see at cons is giant size games. Of the ones that were on the halls, four of these really caught my eye. First, though, was Giant Galaxy Trucker. Someone actually took the core game tiles, all of them from the base game, and put them onto the back of floor tiles. They had carpets with the first ship layout on them, giant cards for people to use, and they even had giant crew and aliens that were awesome. I wanted to take a crew member home to like put on the shelf behind me. That was just cool to see. Next, there was Giant King of Tokyo with huge standees, and the dice were perfect. Like it looks like someone upscaled a King of Tokyo die. I don't know how they managed to pull it off. They were solid in plastic. That was actually outside the hall down the A-pod area. Then the Hachette Games booth had a giant version of the Pac-Man version of Corridor, which is just really cool looking. That one was actually for sale. That wasn't just like a con exclusive. That was something you could buy. And finally, the most impressive to me was Czech Games Edition, or CGE, had a giant Falling Skies table set up in their area. Now, if you don't know this game, this is a solo-only, extremely difficult a puzzle game where you're playing Space Invaders. There are ships coming down from the sky. That's the Falling Skies. And you're trying to destroy them all before they get to your base at the bottom. Well, they had this giant thing that was sloped so high that the top of it was higher than my head with the little, you know, Space Invader looking guys. It just looked awesome.
It looked like a Plinko table. I know you kept trying to get me to go over there and demo it, but it was always busy. And it did look fascinating. You could buy the giant Pac-Man. That's amazing. I had no clue that was actually for sale.
If you look at my picture of it, the price tag's there.
Yeah, I noticed a price tag, and I think I assumed it was just for the regular size version. But yeah, no, that's super cool. So speaking of CGE, Nathan gave us an overview of their latest game, which does not quite exist yet, SETI. And I tossed a reel up on Instagram of us getting an overview of this game, which I will note, it was a prototype version. But it looks super enjoyable in a crunchy kind of way. I love that it's science fact versus science fiction. Like, it's more Asimov than Heinlein. They take the one liberty of saying that the SETI program finds alien life, and then they run with it from there. It had some cool-looking pieces as far as, like, table presence and stuff, like a little 3D sun in the middle, and the universe actually twists, and there's modular pieces, like asteroids that can puzzle slot in as certain things happen in the game that can change that layout. But the game looked awesome, and I want to play it.
Again, the cosplayers that were there, again, sponsored by Rubber City Cosplay. Returning from last year was Mage Knight, who's a fantastic actual police officer who does cosplay on the side. And then as well, new cosplayers there this year were Paige Sickle, Aka Kyoga, Gnosa Costuming, Mog Shell Cosplay, and in an interesting twist, Toothless the Puppy, who is an actual service dog cosplayer.
Another interesting thing that happened on Thursday is I got to sit down in one of Carolina Game Table's new dragon chairs. For members of our Discord, I was sharing pictures of that actually just before the con. I wasn't expecting to see it there. Yes, it was very comfy. I would love to replace our current wingback chairs in our front room with these, but they are well out of our price range. Not to say they're ridiculous, but they're not cheap.
They were just grabbing people out of the crowd and basically forcing you to sit down. I went back another time without you, Mo, and they were like, you, come here, sit. And I get why, because I was like, oh, wow. Yeah, this is comfy. No wonder you're forcing everyone to sit in the chairs. And the person that I was talking to was not the same person you had spoken to, but the gentleman you had spoken to the first time, he's like, I put a lot of thought into designing this. And he's like, and I did this and this, and the arms are just, and I was like, yep, you sure did, because is so cozy. I'm not gonna lie, I want one. And but the shipping to Canada, could you imagine?
Oh
no, I'm gonna have to strap it to the back of the van. That's the only way it's getting here.
Yeah, no, there was, it's interesting because while Game Toppers is a, I believe, a premier sponsor of the event, they aren't the only people there. And again, Carolina Game Tables had some great stuff, and it's interesting because they don't completely overlap. You can get a full game table from Game Toppers, but a lot of what they do is just that Game Toppers, where you're adding on to your existing setup, whereas Carolina Game Table is really about a beautiful furniture that is also useful.
Now, one of our fans suggested we check out the Poly Studios booth, and I gotta say, they have some really nice ceramic mugs and potions and like vases. Mostly though, we ended up talking shop with them a bit, as they really exploded on Twitch and got their start there. And it was pretty amazing. We were kind of sharing tips back and forth. And the one story they like to tell is they have a cat, and they are a place that does ceramic things, like handmade ceramics. And they're like, the best thing that can happen to us during a stream is that our cat comes up and touches a mug we're making or a vase or whatever. Because if they do that, we can sell it for at least twice the price, because the fans want the one that was touched by the cat. So I thought that was pretty amusing and just proves that the internet is run by cats.
That's a hoot. I wasn't there for that conversation. I had taken a break to go sit down because I was exhausted. And now I'm really sad I missed out on it.
Yeah, they were great people, because we just reached out to them because we were wondering how they knew tech. And Mo had approached them and asked if they knew who tech was by real name. And they had no idea who we were talking about. But as soon as we said tech, they immediately went, oh, tech. Yeah, of course. Oh, yeah. And because tech joins them in their streams. And again, it's that whole parasocial relationship rather than, you know, through the wires. We know each other sort of thing.
It's a small internet after all. Eventually, Thursday, we found our way back to the Queen booth, where we had an extremely positive meeting with Travis, details of which we hope to share later. That's something we're very hyped about that we can't tell you about yet. After that, all three of us sat down and played a game of Daba Walla. This was the newest release from Queen Games coming out at the convention. This was an interesting game about delivering tiffins, where the first half of the game, you are trying to stack them as efficiently as possible in the 3x3 grid on the back of your cart, and they're various size polyominoes. And then the second half of the game, you score your tiffins layer by layer. And this was interesting. It was an interesting medium weight game. They called it, four people who are looking for something a little heavier than Ticket to Ride. And they ended up selling out of that one by the end of the con, too. So congrats, Queen Games.
Yeah, it was really interesting the way you spend the first half of the game building up layers of polyomino tiles. And I think I made a mistake by building it flat across, because there was a bonus to, not a bonus per se, but there was a good strategy to getting your cart higher up, more levels up than someone else, because you would score round 7 for 7 tiles up, and then you'd score round 6 and round 5. And if you're the only ones in these top ones, and you're the only one scoring up here, because so that could be very beneficial, right? It was definitely a game where you need to play it again, because that first play, you're just going to get the gist of it, because it is such a unique mechanic with the way you layer up your cart in the first half, and then you take it down layer by layer and sell it off, basically, and make your points. And it was neat.
Yeah, and while you're selling it off, it's not like it's just scoring. You're not just going through the layers. The whole thing that's happening at that time is you're using the cards you drafted to build your stack to manipulate the market. to adjust the price value. So it's not like the second half was just, okay, unstack your stuff and get points. It was a whole like separate mini game after the first half of the game.
Yeah, it's all about, again, it's collecting the tiffins from the households and then delivering the tiffins to the office workers where they might be. And it is very clearly broken into those two sections of games, but interlinked as well through the card play and action. I was really intrigued by it. I did well because it was my first play. I will horribly crash and burn anytime I ever play the game again, but it was interesting. And I think that was actually the only game I fully played the entire time we were there.
The full game? Yeah, that's possible.
Sean won.
We spent a lot of time doing demos at these cons just so we can fit in as much as possible. But yes, note this, Sean beat Deanna at a Queen Games game.
It's true. And the rep from Queen Games as well. So Sean won and is now going to go home, put a little plaque on the wall, and never play Dabawala again. That was the...
And no, we did not bring a review copy because of them selling out, right? Good for Queen. Now we wrapped up the night with the first ever Tabletop Bellhop Origins meetup, which was a ton of fun. Brewcadia, I love the place. Like, I get it. I'm a craft beer fan and I grew up playing classic video games. So it's kind of made for me. It's a great venue. They have a great beer selection. Everyone was playing video games and their pizza was actually better than I remembered. I would now say that it's not only like the best pizza I've had in Ohio. It's some of the better pizza I've had in the U.S. We handed out some swag to our fans and played a round of caution signs from Wise Wizard Games, which we mentioned we had picked up earlier in the day. And it was a huge hit. Like, caution signs at this point, I've now played it twice. I've watched a couple games being played at the booth with the designer. And it's up there now, to me, right up there with Telestrations and Mondrosity for great, fantastic drawing games. And there's some keys to this. One of them being a super short drawing time. Like, you have no idea how little time you have. You have 20 seconds to draw. And at our meetup, I actually gave everyone 30 seconds to give them more of a chance. And that's not a lot of time. So what this does is eliminates any advantage someone who actually knows how to draw, because you just have to get that gist across, that generic shape or that motion. Speed matters way more than skill. And the big thing in this game is it's a deduction game, not social deduction, a deduction game where after everyone's drawn, the person then has to figure out what everyone tried to draw with a selection of, I don't know, caution and sign are the two types, like the two halves of the caution signs that everyone randomized. And to make it interesting, you throw in random ones from the deck. So you never know. You never have perfect information. That game is huge. It is awesome. I am bringing this out tomorrow night, and it's going to be a huge hit tomorrow night at Walkerville, too.
You got a couple of false leads in there, and then you have the other ones that everyone was drawing their stuff based off of, and it's all mixed in, and you're trying to figure out which is which. One person's a guesser, and everyone else draws, and you take turns. It's not my sort of game. But for the type of game it is so very solid. And we had fun playing it. And I don't really care for Monstrosity either. I only play it because my kids love it, right? It's just not my style of game. But, like, it's super solid. The meetup was super relaxed and fun. I love Brewcadia. They have Galaga there, and they let me play it for free. They have a very tasty beer. Pizzas, I just don't care about pizza. It was food. Mo says it was good. It must have been good. He's a pizza fanatic. But yeah, I was super thankful that Brewcadia allowed us to reserve a spot. So that was awesome. And I hope to do it again next year.
Yeah, it was enjoyable pizza. I think going best in America is a bit of a stretch.
Not best in America.
It was perfectly serviceable pizza. It is not something I would complain about being served at any time. Caution signs proves that I can't draw, and everyone laughs at me when I try. And it's a simple game. You get an adjective and a noun, and you have to draw it. And the really interesting thing is there are so many similar adjectives that could come up. And so while your noun may be whatever, you don't have enough time really to sort of nail that the look of your noun, especially when you have these adjectives that you need to add in there and differentiate with. Except all of a sudden, you know, when the person who's looking through realizes that, oh, these are very, you know, is it fast or is it quick? Little things like that, where you really have to struggle to figure out what it is and hope that a card that's way similar to yours doesn't come up if you want to get guessed.
And it did. Every time. Like, you'd get something you would think would be pretty straightforward. I'm going to draw a loving alligator. And then someone else looks at the words and goes, well, it's got hearts on it. It must be cute. It's a cute alligator. It's a happy, cute alligator. And I'm like, no, it isn't. Or you're like, this is a bear, clearly a bear. But they also drew the card for panda. And you're like,
I will point out Sean was wrong because he played a full game of caution signs as well and won. So
that's true. But that wasn't in the con. That was outside the con.
Yeah, I got to say this. We are going to try to make this an annual thing. Now, we will try to do a little better, making sure it doesn't overlap with the big Gamma member reception. Oops. Sorry. Totally missed that. And I got to say, based on how well the drinks and food were going down, I don't think Brewcadia will mind us coming back.
Yeah, having it at the same time as the Gamma reception sucked. That was definitely not intentional. And we would not have done that if we had more prior notice of when the Gamma events were going to be scheduled. So here's to not double booking ourselves next year.
And I do have to thank Eric at our meetup. That night ended with Rap Rat. This is a DVD game that was released in 1992, which I had never heard of. Eric brought it up when I mentioned Atmosphere or I can't remember the other version, Nightmare. No, we didn't play the game, but we watched the video. And I think all of you must share in our pain. And when we're done recording tonight, or when you're done listening to this, look it up on YouTube and then you can curse us for the rest of our lives. Because, oh my gosh, I feel sorry for any parent of any kid who actually liked this game.
I may have nightmares of Rap Rat. That thing was terrifying.
Yeah, I was really shocked to find at the end of the video, there were actually people willing to put their names in the credits and associate themselves with this product. Because I'm sorry, I would have used a pseudonym if I'd been involved in that. But of course, one of the booths we had to stop at while at Origins was booth 1233, the Grand Gamers Guild booth, who is, of course, our sponsor. And they had a very good Origins.
They not only sold out of Tir na n'Og, which was the number one game on the Board Game Geek Origins hotness list going into the convention, I think thanks in part to you, our fans. You're awesome. They also sold out of other games, including La Familia Hort.
Now, Mark even told us about a pair who bought a copy of La Familia Hort and came back the next day to share that they had played it 8 times that night and it went over well. It was a huge hit.
Now, with Origins done and over, the next step for Grand Gamers Guild is the road to Gen Con. And they would love your help again by giving their games a thumbs up on the BGG Gen Con 2024 preview list, similar to what we did for them for the Origins list, which worked out oh so well.
We have just dropped a link to that in the chat, or for those of you listening, you can find a link in the show notes.
And if you are attending Gen Con, be sure to check out the Grand Gamers Guild booth at booth number 2838. Be sure to tell them the Tabletop Bellhop sent you. Origins Game Fair D3 Friday.
So we actually spent most of Friday morning, a significant portion of time, hanging out with the awesome folks at the Outset Media booth, which is also somehow the Cheatwell Games booth. These two companies seem to be very well connected. I don't know all the details. And I got to say, it seems we must have made an impression with our Psychobabble and Zensu reviews after Origin last year. Remember how when we reviewed Psychobabble, we talked about Outset Media guy and how he forced us to take Psychobabble home after trying out Zensu? Well, he was very excited to meet us. We did learn his name is Paul, but I did confirm he is totally fine for the rest of time being Outset Media guy. So thank you, Outset Media guy. Now, what Outset Media guy did is he hooked us up with Kedrick Winks. That is the designer of Psychobabble. And we got to sit down and play a couple of Kedrick's new games.
Yes, Paul is actually from Cheatwell Games, which, if I understand things correctly, is a UK games publisher that has teamed up with Outset to have their games released in North America. But I could be off on that. Apparently, he's also very cool just being called Outset Media guy.
Yeah. And apparently, as we understand it, there is a merger in the works where Cheatwell and Outset are going to be the same eventually.
Yeah, as far as I can tell, they're the same. Like, if I post a piece of content, there's like a 50-50 chance I'll get a reply from one or the other. Cheatwell is more active. Again, props to Outset Media guy. We wouldn't even be talking about you now and wouldn't have had a great Friday morning without that connection. So thank you for that. Now, the first game we played with Kedrick was Shadow Ninjas. This is a cat-themed one-versus-many semi-hidden movement game. A very big fog of war. Now, as Kedrick was describing this game, I was getting flashback to Cats, a game I own and still play and have talked about on the show many times. Amusingly, Outset Media Guy was a playtester on Cats, known as Cat Mansion. So that was an interesting bit of correlation there. Now, getting back to Shadow Ninjas, this is a samurai-themed game where one player plays two royal guards trying to protect the shogun's koi fish. Now, the other players are playing the Shadow Ninjas who are trying to sneak past the guards and catch the valuable and oh-so-delicious koi. Now, like Cats or Cat's Mansion, no one knows who anyone else is or which token is theirs. And to make things interesting, there are a number of shadow tokens whose symbols on the back match the symbols of the Shadow Ninja Cats. Each turn, you're rolling two dice and you're moving two tokens. They don't have to be yours. You can move any token. If a guard gets line of sight to a token, they flip it over. And if it is a player's cat, they're eliminated. And that's probably about all I want to get into here. It was a ton of fun. I think this is going to be a huge hit at our public play events, and I expect our kids will also love it.
There ends up being a lot of Shadow Ninja Cat tokens out moving around. I think you were given like yours plus four decoys to place, and then keeping track of where yours is and trying to guess where the other people playing have their tokens is challenging. And there's an interesting mechanic where whenever two of the Shadow Ninja tokens come up against each other, they kind of do-si-do and swap spots. So it's one of the ways to mix up the tokens. And if you do that a couple times, you know, you can throw people off the trail. One person is playing the two dog guards and he's trying to come down and catch everybody. The line of sight rules didn't work the way I thought they would. Like, you would think that the Shadow Ninjas in front of you would block line of sight. But no, if they can see straight down a line, they see everything straight down that line. It's all flipped and caught over. And if your Shadow Ninja is flipped, that's it. You're out. So there is player elimination, but the game's relatively quick. I mean, Sean got eliminated first, and you said it was still interesting enough to sit there and play it. Yeah, it's a neat game.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think because of the player elimination, it is going to turn off some people. But trying to figure out where everyone is and who, like the people who weren't eliminated, and trying to guess at which is which and who is who, allows you to sort of not taking part, be invested in the game. You still want the cats to win. I thought the really interesting thing was the original pitch of this game, which is a perfectly family friendly cats and dogs and trying to eat koi in a, you know, it was originally an Afghanistan, Call of Duty mission, sneaking past cameras type thing, where the Outset Media people said, well, hold on, let's just, you know, peel this all back, distill it down to the root of the game and make it fun with cats.
I would be curious to try the version that has cameras or some mechanical equivalent that you had to sneak past. I would be curious about that. But the game's lovely as it sits.
And it was interesting. I think the player elimination was worse than usual because Kedrick did note that was the longest game he'd ever played and that we are really good at bluffing. So we did keep it going, I think, a little longer than expected. Now, I will admit being interrupted by fans, both ours and his, during the game did make it a little difficult, more difficult than usual to keep track. After that, Kedrick then convinced us to try the Crooked Crown. A fast-playing card game about goblins fighting over a rather beat-up crown. It's pretty simple. Each turn, you're going to play a set of cards that are all the same, that all do the same thing, with the only goal being to be the player holding the crown card at the end of eight rounds. This is a super take-that game with a ton of back and forth. What it reminded me of is we talk about the Deadlies a lot from Smirk and Dagger. We love this game. We've talked about it quite a bit. And then we always talk about the point where someone gets the Halo card and how the kind of whole game changes to fight over the card. Well, this is that part of the Deadlies, except it's the whole game. This, I think, is going to be a big hit at our brewery game nights. We did take home review copies of this and Shadow Ninjas. I'm really looking forward to showing those off and playing with the local gamers. And we've also got some special treats from Cheatwell Games for possibly some future giveaways.
That is such a good analogy with the Deadlies, because that is exactly what this is. It's the, I know you have the Halo, the crown, and now everyone's going to be trying to scramble to get it. And the Halo is always out in those first sets of... So someone always has the Halo. You just don't know who. And your hand size is going to move up and down because of certain take that aspects. And you're stealing cards from people. They're stealing them back. You're peeking over there. You're pretty sure he has it. Or you're trying to make sure everyone thinks he has it because you have it. It's that.
Yeah. And the really interesting thing is, while you can peek at people's hands, whenever you're stealing cards, you are stealing blind. So you never really know if someone has successfully stolen the crown or not. So it's really easy to mistake who has the crown at any given moment.
Next, we stopped by the Smirk and Dagger booth. We got a rundown on Hi-Fi. Check out our Instagram for that. Kurt does a great job of summing up the game for us, and I'm even more excited about it than I was before. It looks fantastic. We tried out Tesseract, a cooperative game that includes a dice stack on an actual Lazy Susan. The game comes with this little tiny Lazy Susan where you're going to draft dice from the cube and then use asymmetric powers to try to create sets, trying to stop the world from ending due to core breaches. We then played through a full game of This Game is Killer, which I totally thought was going to be a social deduction game, but wasn't at all. This is a very take that card game that is basically Alien the movie, but as a party game. Kurt insisted we take this one home, and he was so right with the Deadly, so we figured why not. And we also grabbed review copies of Tesseract as well as Adventure Party. And with Adventure Party, we also got a very cute Mimic promo.
Tesseract, I have looked at many times, and it's always intrigued me. And I remember we wanted to get a copy at
Gamma Expo.
I think it was Gamma Expo, and they were sold out. And I think even last year at Origins, they sold out. Or it was between printings at Gamma Expo. So I've wanted it for a while, and I've been eyeing this game for a while and been very interested in it. But I never knew that it had that Lazy Susan mechanic, which just makes everything so... I'm like, that's brilliant. That physical piece there just makes the game... I'm assuming the game flow will be much smoother because of that. I'm really looking forward to playing it. This Game is Killer is not the game I thought it was. It's a party game where you're trying to survive as long as you can and be last man standing on a alien infested ship. And there's no social deduction. There's none of those things that I don't like in a party game. We did run a demo game of it. It was okay. I need to play it some more to get I just haven't made up my mind on that one yet.
Yeah, I'm interested in seeing how that Aliens game plays out. I was really intrigued by Hi-Fi, though. Tesseract is going to be interesting, but I'm reserving, until I actually play that, I'm sort of reserving thoughts for it. Tesseract, again, is still mostly complete preview, but it was way more involved than I would have expected for a game of this nature. Mm-hmm. The concept is simple. You're rebuilding the B-side of an album that came out 50 years ago where they only ever recorded the A-side, and now you're trying to, you know, release the B-side and make it a full album. Simple enough concept, but the interesting interaction and, you know, people, you know, working on guitar equalization so that when someone else lays down a guitar track, both people get points and interesting things like that mean that it's a much more complex game than it would appear. But when you just look at a pretty record player. So,
yeah, no, it was Kurt described it as a puzzly thinky game in the reel a tight, puzzly, thinky game, and I'm super looking forward to playing that, but it does not exist yet. It's supposed to come out at Gen Con.
Yep.
Yeah, and that's another one we've seen the evolution of, and it just keeps looking better every time. One of the things Deanna noted I missed is the rule book looks like a Rolling Stones cover, and the band you're trying to recreate the music for is the Meeples. Deanna noticed the latest edition actually has a shout-out to Boop, one of Smirk and Dagger's most popular games now.
Yeah, it has a silly line along top, something about like Boop, the new dance craze taking the nation or something like it's part of the magazine cover. And
thought that was cute.
I thought that was cute.
We did have a quick meeting with Thunderworks Games. This was a nice in and out because we had things set up ahead of time. We picked up review copies of Stone Spine Architects, which is from the same designer as Cartographers and is about building a dungeon. And we grabbed a copy of Metro Runner, the cyberpunk hacking game, pick up and deliver around the metro while trying to solve puzzles and hack systems that looks fantastic. I'm really looking forward to checking out both of those.
Yeah, Metro Runner isn't quite out yet. It's supposed to be a Gen Con release. We got to do a partial demo at Gamma Expo, and I have been super excited about checking out this game ever since.
Yeah, no, Metro Runner looks fantastic, and I can't wait to get it on the table.
Stone Spire Architects too, they both look great. But yeah.
Next was a meeting with Court from Cosmos, who introduced us to Nunatak. I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Nunatak Temple of Ice. That's due out later this year. This is a really eye-catching game about building temples one block at a time, where you're trying to put temples into the four corners on a grid. And when you do that, you place a new tile. So now there's a new layer where you can now place temples and build up. And what's really fascinating about this is Court called it out, and I hadn't noticed it before, is this is kind of a gamer version of the classic dot game that many of us played as a kid, where you can set off the chain reaction of putting in a temple, which then causes you to complete one, which can then cause you to complete another one. And I thought that was a really neat game. The table presence here was fantastic. There were some really interesting things going on with like card drafting and where you could place your temples, and the scoring system was very cool. And like every time you completed a new layer, there was an area majority scoring for whoever had the most temples. It's a lot more going on than I expected. I am looking forward to seeing more of that one once it's fully released. Now, she also showed us Belrati, which is an interesting image-based cooperative deduction game, which reminds me of games like Ven or Dixit, as it's about making connections between images. Except this is cooperative, where one round someone is throwing in cards and the other half of the table are playing the art critics or the owners of the museum. And then you switch off and then you swap. And it was neat. It was interesting. And like I said, the big twist here is one of those, you know, image association games. But instead of being a competitive party game, this was a cooperative one.
There was something about Nunatak that I just found really compelling. Like, we only played a partial game, and I was like, no, we must keep going. I wish to play this through to completion. I think I'm looking forward to getting that one to the table eventually. Then after that, we were walking around on the floor, and we happened nearer to the Floodgate games booth, and I was literally kidnapped. I stopped to sort of look over to see what they were doing, some kind of game demo. And I was just like, you, here, take a hand. You're now playing. And it was a real-time Dex game. And that is terrifying. It was Skyrockets. It was called Skyrockets. It's about setting off fireworks. And you have a hand. And there's all these different colored timers out on the board. And if I play a red and a green card, I can flip both the red and the green timer. And we are trying to make sure that none of the timers ever run out. So on my turn, I want to flip the timers that are closest to running out. I don't want to flip the timers. We're talking about egg timers. I don't want to flip the egg timer that has no time if I flip it, right? That would be bad. And so you're trying to adjust as it's coming around the table. I think I'm going to play the red and green. No, he played that. And this has actually took longer to come around than I thought. And you might even stall and not play quite yet because you're like, I'm going to play, okay, blue and green, now flip them, you know, so,
eh. And one of the timers that was out was the what you were trying to progress to win. Mm-hmm. And from what I understood from Ian, who described the game to us, that was like the first scenario was one color. You just had to get flipped enough times that you won, and that there's a whole like multi-part campaign to this where it just gets more and more difficult.
He showed tons of variants on the game that you could play. And I thought, this game, I could sort of deal with. Anything beyond that was a nervous breakdown in a box, as far as I'm concerned. So definitely not my style of game. But it was really clever, and everyone at the table was having a good time playing it. And I think it's a solid game.
And we did take a review copy of this home, so I am looking forward to seeing how this plays with people who actually like real-time dexterity-based games. Because I know in the second scenario, you have to stack timers on top of other timers, and you can't flip the ones underneath until the top ones are flipped. And that just sounds ridiculous.
Yeah, he started describing that, and I was like, this is a heck no.
Now, around this time, I disappeared off into another area of the convention, and that is the panels. So this year at Origins was something a little different that they haven't done much of in the past, and that was celebrity guests. So they had a big group of celebrity guests this year. Last year, they had a couple, but they didn't really do much, and they were kind of buried off in a corner, and it was hard to find them even if you did want to see anything. Well, this time, they had a large area, and I have to say that the autograph and photo sessions may not have gone as well as Gamma was hoping they would have. I know a lot of these people had minimums, and they probably had to pay out some money for these guests, unfortunately, but they also did guest panels and they played some extra games. Now, unfortunately, I missed Celebrity Uno. I didn't hear that one was going and I am very upset about that. But the first panel I did happen into was that of Kevin Sussman, better known to some people as Stuart from
Big Bang Theory.
Big Bang Theory. Yes, thank you. So Kevin Sussman, better known as Stuart from Big Bang Theory. He was a delightful person. Everything you think about him from watching him on that show is kind of really who he is. He's just this delightfully friendly, kind of geeky guy who likes games and likes entertainment and was a pure joy to talk with. The host of the of all the panels was Craig Price from Matinee Heroes podcast. And he had very clearly done a lot of research and made sure he knew what to talk about with these guests to keep them talking, whether or not there were people from the audience asking questions or not. I think my big thrill for the end of that was at the end of it, I stopped Kevin and just said, hey, you know, here I'm media at this event. Could I just grab a quick picture of you? Handed him a copy of our Tabletop Bellhop business card, which he looked at and said, oh, I follow you guys on Twitter. That kind of made my night. And for anyone who's seen it on Facebook already, he held up our card as I took his picture.
Still at the Floodgate Games booth, we took an early look at Hedge Mage, not Maze, Mage. The big thing Ian was trying to sell us on that one is that it can be played with any number of players. And his goal for Gen Con is to arrange a 100-player game. And the reason this game can play any number of players is that you play with yourself, the person on your left, and your person on the right. And that's it. Now, this is an abstract puzzle game that's using polyominoes and an action point movement system that is all about bringing garden gnomes to life. Now, this was a prototype and it looked pretty cool, and I'm looking forward to hearing more about this one later.
Yeah, I'm super curious about a 100-person game. I want to see that happen. I went and checked out the Geekify booth. Now, Geekify takes books and rebinds them is one of the things that they do, and they make these gorgeous leather-bound books. The ones that Mo was eyeballing is they've rebound some of like the Dungeon Master Guide and the Monster Book, you know, classics like that, right? I think the giant Curse of Strahd hardcover was one of the ones I was looking at that had the most beautiful cover. I have some video that I'm going to put up on Instagram at some point of some of the books. They have this copy of Labyrinth that I really want because it's like a mock-up of the copy that Sarah carries around in the movie, and it has a relatively rare print of the book inside of it that I would love to have a copy, but they're expensive. They're like $200-$300, but they're beautiful pieces of art. And they also have the IP license for all the Last Unicorn stuff, and they do like giant tapestries and pins and stuff, and they've got this new tarot set out for the Last Unicorn that's really pretty, and they have a wooden box and thing. It's just, you know, it's a booth full of pretty things that I could stare at all day. We're an affiliate for them. I almost never share their stuff online because I don't know why, because it doesn't fit into our content that often. I should tell you guys about it more often. You should go buy it. It's pretty. Mo should buy some for me. Christmas wish list, Geekify booth. Thank you. The end.
Again, while that was going on, after Kevin's panel wrapped up, I ducked upstairs to another one of the giant exhibition halls where they were doing a Six Sides of Gaming celebrity D&D game. So this is an ongoing, I believe it's actually charity organized D&D game where they are playing with some of the greats of D&D and exploring the worlds that some of these greats actually created. In an interesting they're rebuilding a deck of many wonders by collecting the cards from all these different realms. And it features Ed Greenwood and Kevin, I'm forgetting his name, will hopefully remind me, Kevin, who wrote
Baker.
Kevin Baker. And then they would bring in also other guests from the show. So they would, they brought in the first guest I saw, was Kevin Sussman got to play along with them. And Kevin doesn't play D&D.
Keith Baker, that's what threw me off.
Keith Baker.
You said Kevin, and I'm like, that doesn't sound right. It's definitely Baker.
Yes.
Keith Baker. That's the man behind Eberron.
Yes. And Luke Gygax was another one who was playing in all of those games. And if you don't know who Gygax is, well, I don't know what to say. They would literally just hand these guests who'd never played D&D before a character sheet and say, here you go, read your description, and that's the character you're playing. And they were guides from the solar organization that was helping work on this mystery and try and guide people along from world to world. So that was really interesting and really fun to get involved with.
I have to say, I usually have no interest in going to these panels, and you kept coming back from them and making them sound so flipping fascinating. I was like, I am missing out. I want to be two places at once. Is that one in particular? And there's another D&D based one that you did later that I was like, I want to be there. That sounds super fascinating.
Oh, well, Sean was off. We got a walkthrough of Chicken Fried Dice. This is a game coming from Urban Professional Games. This is a dice based roll and write with a very punny theme. Would love to share the overview, but this was another one where it went a little long. So for some reason, social media wouldn't let me upload the video. So expect you might be able to see Deanna might be able to cut that one down a bit and get it up. But yeah, very fun theme game, rolling dice, placing them on a play mat with some interesting progression that had to be made to complete your recipes.
So it's real time race for speed type game, which is so not for me. But I have to edit this video down. I didn't realize that you weren't able to upload it because this gentleman had his pitch down. Oh, yeah. It was perfect. And so many chicken fried puns in there. And there was a lot of neat, very tightly themed mechanics in the game, like taking your dice into the kitchen and chopping them in half for ingredients for your things. And, you know, like different stuff like that. That I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. Not for me, but pretty cool.
Yeah. And then again, another panel. I jumped back downstairs from the D&D panel back into the original hall where they were doing Celebrity One Night Ultimate Werewolf. Now, we have all talked about the fact that we're not big social deduction fans, and I've never actually played any of the werewolf games, so I was surprised because Ultimate One Night Werewolf is significantly different than the werewolf that most people know about. It's an interesting game. They played a few rounds. I was only there for the first round, but there were a wide number of people there. There was Kevin Sussman. There was Tommy Rice, Dane DeLegro, Adrian Paul, as well as Stephen Bonacore. And they even brought up someone from the audience to join in and play as well. And it was hosted by one of the publisher's reps there for the game. So the person who was hosting the game definitely knew what was going on and how to play that game and how to manage it to the best of the ability of their ability. They did a fantastic job. And the finger pointing at the end and the dodging and avoiding was hilarious. And the werewolves actually did get killed at the end of it. They got it right. Despite no one actually knowing why. That was an interesting one. The cards had been swapped during the ultimate phase where things get moved around, and they did pick a werewolf who was not originally one of the werewolves. So next up we had the Origin Awards, and so we were back up into that the last hall that had held the D&D, we were looking forward to this one as we were nominated, even though we hadn't expected a win.
We wrapped up Friday night at the Origins Awards, which were pretty solid this year. Only a few technical hiccups. Like last year, I live tweeted the winners as they were announced. So check my X feed for that. I guess you don't call it tweeting anymore anywhere. Anyway, highlights for the start of the show were Bonacore's jacket, of course. The Hall of Fame inductees, which included Matt Leacock, Rebecca Gay, Labyrinth the board game. They even threw in the German designer of the game. This is Ravensburger's Labyrinth. So that was kind of interesting. He had a translator saying thank you. Twilight Struggle, the game, Christopher Rush, Terry Amthor, Dave Tramp Trampier, and In Memoriam, James Ward and Janelle Jaquet.
I'm going to segue here for a second and say, I wish I could remember the designer's name. It was actually fascinating because he didn't just pop in to say hi. He actually talked about the development of the game and how he had been fiddling around with it for a while. And then Rubik's Cube came out and how that playing with the Rubik's Cube made him go back to the table with this game and eventually figure out how he wanted it to slide and move and stuff. So it was an interesting, speech from him. There was a lot of interesting speeches throughout the night. KTBG ended up winning Best Children's Game for Dice Veggies. Best Co-op went to Sky Team from Scorpion Mask. Best Gateway Game went to Wandering Towers from Capstone. The Best Heavy Duty Game went to Dune Imperium Uprising from Dire Wolf. The Best Light Game went to Leaf from Weird City. The Best Thematic Game went to Freelancers from Plaid Hat. The Best Party Game went to Smug Owls. And the Best Solo Game went to Legacy of You from Renegade Games.
Furthermore, Best Artwork went to Quanshai Moria. The Best Writing went to Grace Collins. Best Media Production, the category we were a finalist in, went to Making Board Games, the CGE documentary. The Best Mini Game was Star Wars Shatterpoint from Atomic Mass. And the Best Puzzle Game went to Threads of Fate from Post Curious.
I feel bad that I mentioned all the other companies and not Smug Owls, which I believe is from Runaway Parade.
Best RPG Adventure was Hecna from Hit Point Press. Best RPG Core Product was Die, the role-playing game. Best RPG Starter Set went to the Dreams and Machine Starter from Modiphius. And the Best RPG Supplement was one for Dune, Power, and Pawns, also from Modiphius.
Then the final award was the Fan Favorite Award, the only award that the people at the Origins Convention got to vote on, and it went to Distilled from Paverson Games.
Now, note, that's not every category, just the ones we figured people would be most interested in. Find a link to the full list of winners in the show notes.
Congratulations to all the winners and the nominees. Thanks to the selection committee for making us a finalist. Hopefully, we'll be back with another chance at a win next year.
Origins Game Fair, Day 4, Saturday.
So the day started off with the discovery of Pinatures. These were found at the Foam Brain Games booth. Wow, that came out weird. Foam Brain Games booth. These are an awesome combination of collectible pin and miniature. It's a pin that you'd wear that shows your character on it, or a creature, or a goblin, or something. And it has a symbol at the bottom, like a book or a rune or a pedestal. Well, that folds down to become a base, and you can then use your pin as a miniature. And I thought that was absolutely brilliant. They had Pathfinder-themed miniatures, as well as generic fantasy ones. I did ask about supers for you, Sean, but they haven't done anything but fantasy so far.
Yeah, those were just like a neat surprise that I either didn't know or had forgotten existed. I had gone over there to look at the, like, they have a large selection of enamel pins. They, Foam Brain Games runs the Pin Bazaar for Origins. Like, they're, I think they make all the pins for the Pin Bazaar for Origins. They make custom enamel pins. And I went over there to look and see there's anything I needed to grab for our pin collecting child, and just to look at them because they're gorgeous. And I wanted to show Mo the charm bracelets because those are also cool. And then we're like, oh, nifty pin miniatures.
So the first thing I did on Saturday was check out a panel hosted guest with Dane DeLegrio. And now this one was kind of interesting because I had no idea who Dane DeLegrio was, or DeLegro was. It just mentioned that he was a stuntman and he'd done some work in Prey and he'd done some work in Guardians of the Galaxy, but I had no idea who this man was. So I went in, and true to form, Craig had done his research and knew everything he needed to know about Dane. And Dane was a wonderful and exuberant person who didn't have enough guests in his panel and was very overflowingly welcoming to anyone who walked in that door from the first person who walked in to the last. So it turns out that Dane is actually a 6'8" professional, or former professional basketball player, Tuscan Butcher, as well as the man who played Predator in the movie Prey. And I mean all of it. He did all the stunt work. He did all the motion capture, all of it. As well, he did some work in Walking Dead and Guardians of the Galaxy 3. Now, if you don't think a man who has been a professional basketball player and a Tuscan butcher, as well as being a stuntman and movie star, is interesting, well, I don't know what to say. This was a captivating panel, and it was so sad that there were maybe 15 or 20 people in the audience. The panels were just way under attended for the amazing information and eye-opening stories these people had to tell.
And Deanna and I missed it all because we spent the day wandering the exhibit hall, because at this point, note we're on day 4, we still hadn't seen all of it. Yes, it's that big, especially when you break up the day with meetings and actually doing demos. Yes, I'm sure it can be done in one day if you rush and walk quickly and only stop at the booths that really interest you. But like for us, exploring the hall took 3 total days. One of the things that happened while we were exploring is we ran into a fan playing caution signs with Danielle, which was amusing because I went up and I wanted to get a picture and video of her teaching her own game, right? She was the co-designer of this. And I asked if I could take pictures of this family playing, and they all seemed to have a lot of fun. And they said yes, and then the dad turned over and looked at me and went, oh, for you, yes, hell yes. Please, it would be an honor. And I kind of looked at him and said, oh, I'm a longtime fan. So that was pretty awesome.
That was a fun moment, right? We didn't expect that. I was giving Mo heck because we meet all these cool people and designers and stuff and never take photos with them or of them. We just take pictures of games. And I'm like, you need to go back around and get some pictures of people. So we were like backtracking and going, hey, you got a second?
Yes, I now have a small collection of pictures of me with designers holding their games. So it's not quite everyone, but I did get more this year. It's something I hope to improve on.
Yeah, there's a whole thing about, you know, taking pictures with designers that people do, people who like selfies more than we do, younger generations who are more into these selfie thing. But there was also, we were surprised by the whole signing box tops. Yes. By designers, mm-hmm. that we hadn't really considered, even though that we know a bunch of designers and have chatted with them freely. We never really thought to ask them until Kendrick got distracted every minute or two by signing one of his box tops. So while that was going on, the next panel happened to be Adrian Paul. Now, this was a name I had no idea about, but fans of The Highlander probably know him as The Highlander from the TV series for 6 or 7 seasons, I think it was. Now, he's an interesting fellow who does actually teach swordplay. Of all the panels, this was actually the only one that did any sort of low-key selling of product, because he does run a swordplay experience at cons, which is an interesting one. It's not cheap. It's actually $480 for the full experience. But for that, you get a good chunk of a day working with him, learning swordplay, but also getting filmed and photographed doing this swordplay in a specific theme. He actually designs them for whichever con or city he's in so that it is related to the area and the events taking place. So that's really interesting. As well as that, he also runs tours related to the Highlander TV show. So people will go to Scotland and get to like spend a week touring the castles from the Highlander series and stuff like that. But he is an interesting fellow, and he was the only one who actually made physical contact with the host, Craig, choking him out at one point as he was explaining how he was bit by a stuntman at one point.
Now, one of the things I did was drool over the amazing Fallout scenery in the Modiphius booth. This is not a game I play. I played the video game, but like I'm not into. They have a role-playing game. They have a miniature game. They have a skirmish game. So there's lots of different games that use this scenery. Now, I've seen some of these sets for sale online, and it does not do them justice at all. They are huge. They are big. Like there's one that is a diner that is just amazing with like a rocket shooting out of the top. And it ends up the roof is removable so you can put miniatures on the inside. Well, this entire diner takes up most of a 3x3 table. So if anyone's looking at like the Fallout Wasteland Warfare stuff, This scenery is really impressive. And I got to say, at first, I was thinking the prices seemed a little high, but now seeing just how big it is, you're almost buying a full game table's worth of scenery with one box.
Yeah, I hadn't seen it in person. I had seen it online. I had no clue the scale and like the level of detail. And they're gorgeous. I'm gorgeous for something that looks beat up. they're very, very nice. One of the things I was thinking about is a pro tip for when you go to Origins or conventions like these, you go to the booth and there's people there demoing the games. And sometimes it's the publisher and sometimes it's people that they've brought in that are, you know, fans of games and whatever, and are there helping demo at the booth. And sometimes it's the game designer. So now I'm like, every time I sit down, I'm always trying to like check out the badge. I'm like, let's see if the name matches the name on the box. I'm like, cool, bonus. I collected a designer experience. So because they usually run under the radar. They don't, you know, they don't talk about the fact that you can go here and play with this designer or that, but it's something to keep an eye out for.
No, we haven't talked much about role-playing games at all because it's not something we're all that into right now. Still don't have a group together after COVID. But one of the things I did kind of go over and had to look at were the Warhammer 4th edition books from Cubicle 7. What they had on display was the new deluxe edition of the Lustria book. And man, that looked fantastic. Now, I got to admit, it didn't compare to last year where they had the entire collector's edition of the Enemy Within on display. That made me had to run to the washroom. We just need to play that starter set so that next Origins, I can justify buying Warhammer stuff.
So next, I had my fanboy moment. I'm not a big actual fan of a lot of the celebrity things. They don't, you know, I'm not going to be the one out there going and getting photographs and autographs like that from fans. But I was really excited when they announced they were going to be doing a panel with Scott Grimes and Adrian Palicki from The Orville. Scott Grimes bailed and left poor Adrian dangling all on her own in a panel, unable to field all the questions she could have. And she made sure she spent, probably the first 10 minutes berating Scott Grimes for not arriving. They are good friends. Apparently everyone on the Orville is really actually quite close and friendly. There are no certainties about the Orville season 4. Everyone would like it to happen, but apparently there are other things that are taking precedence. So we have no news about that, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But I have been a huge fan of Adrian from the Orville, from Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., from G.I. Joe Retaliation, from John Wick. Just a big fan of her overall. My wife had loved her in the football series Friday Night Lights. I didn't watch her in that, but I know that was sort of her big moment where she got out of the I'm a pretty girl and into no, I'm a real actress mode was in that series. That was a fantastic panel. And she was just as friendly and cheerful as I had always hoped. So,
yeah, most reason I know her more from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. now, which I got to say, when we started watching that, I was like, where do I know her from? Where do I know her from? And eventually it clicked. It was the Orville. Now, at some point, we stopped by the Runaway Parade booth and picked up a review copy of Smug Owls after chatting with co-designer Grace Kendall and getting a selfie. We, of course, picked this up because of their win at the Origins Award the night before. We talked a bit about the ceremony and how shocked we both were to even be nominated and how happy they were to win. This is a fascinatingly, like, one of those, like, how had no one thought of it before style of party game where you draw cards and are presented with a Sphinx-like riddle but no answer. And the players then try to think of an answer and put their hands on the table when they have one. And then the last player to put their hands down was too slow and then becomes the judge. And then they judge how good everyone's answers are and distribute cards as points. It is fascinating. I am totally bringing this out tomorrow. I think this is going to be a huge hit at our public play events. And I just think the game is so clever.
Even with them having won an award, I'm like, yeah, party game. But Mo and I had split up at one time and at one point, and I was walking around the show floor and someone else was demoing it. And I just kind of walked up to, you know, watch and pay attention. And I went, wait a second. wait a second, this is super clever. I got to go find Mo and make him come back over here. And I'm like, you have to come demo this game. Just come here. Come here. Come check it out.
So I did stomp off into another Six Sides of Gaming. This was another celebrity side quest. This time, their guest was Adam Schenkman, who is known by some people for some people as Gary from Legends of Tomorrow. He has done a ton of work. He is just one of those character actors who you absolutely have seen in any number of things, but probably only one episode here and one episode here. He has just, his IMDb list goes on for ages. But again, if you are a Marvel or DC fan, Legends of Tomorrow was one of his bigger, longer ongoing roles. Again, the GM of these Six Sides of Gaming celebrity side quests was Tommy Grofton. And I also forgot to mention earlier that Eliza Teague was one of the players in that. And these were just really interesting. And again, Adam had not played D&D ever before. They sat down and put him next to Keith. Keith Baker was sort of his helper, and you know, here's the dice you have to roll, which was also next to Ed Greenwood. And let me tell you, anytime you get to see Ed Greenwood and Keith Baker sitting next to each other talking, go run. See those two men just bouncing ideas off each other and jabs at each other. They both have written so much of the lore we love in the fantasy worlds, and they are just wonderful and enjoyable to watch play off each other. You could do a show just with those two people sitting down and throwing random words at them.
So after lunch, Deanna and I got in a demo of Revive, which was pitched to us as, well, you know what a 4X game is, right? Well, this is only a 2X game, but it's the most interesting X's. Only expand and explore. So this is a game about humanity reemerging into the wilds after an apocalypse, which features one of the leader tie-ins of a game to its mechanic. Your player board is a giant engine, and this is an engine building game because you're going to be constantly improving that engine. And you literally, one of the things you have is an on and off switch on the board. It was just really neat. Now, this is a heavier, possibly the heaviest game we brought home from the con. I haven't double checked that on Board Game Geek, but it's also long. This is, you know, 3 hour experience. It looks great. And we did end up grabbing a review copy of this one before the end of the con. And it's great because it has us working with a new publisher, which is Colossal Games, who I need to double check who actually does Revive, because I think Colossal's just bringing it here.
Apto? It starts with an A. I was super excited about this one. Like, I'm like, Mo, I want to see this game. Let's get an overview of this one. I'm like, I picked it up. I looked at the back of the box. I was already vaguely aware of it from online. And I'm like, I like the background. I like the coming back after the apocalypse and finding old tech and stuff. But when he started describing it as a 2X game, I'm like, yep, I'm sold. And then an engine builder where you literally build an engine and run it. I'm like, yep. Oh, yeah. I cannot wait to play that game. And it is, Sean is telling me it's Aporta Games. See, I knew, with an A, something. I was so close.
So this was time I actually ducked back in with the rest of the gang for a little while. And we were standing around in one of the aisles that led towards the guest area. There had been a gentleman who I'd been photographing in a few different events. He'd been in one of the celebrity side quests, and he'd been in the One Night Werewolf. And his name was Tommy Rice. Now, I had no idea who Tommy Rice is. He's an author and a game designer, apparently. I'm not actually sure what game he's designed, but he has worked for GW and a number of fantasy gaming companies. He seems to be best known for The Lock, which is a fantasy book he has authored that is part of a fantasy series. And he's done one of the books in that series. He is also a former NFL player. And this was kind of one of the more obvious things, because this guy is big. I mean, he was really, really big. And we were standing there in the aisle, and along comes, you know, Tommy and one of his, you know, handlers, making sure he's getting to where he needs to go. And he takes up a large portion of the aisle, and he walked straight up to me, and out of the blue, I had no idea who this gentleman was, but he saw my badge and said, hey, Sean, I've seen you taking photographs at a bunch of the events. Thank you for that. Gave me a nearly bone crushing handshake and, you know, was really nice and sweet and went on to his guest things. And it was just one of those fantastic moments where, you know, you realize, oh, yeah, these celebrities really are just people. And every mm-hmm. one of them I met was super cool.
At some point during the day in the afternoon, we did stop by the Grand Gamers Guild booth to see how our sponsor was doing and chatted with Mark for a bit, who was almost giddy with joy how well the con was going for him at this point. He had already sold out of Tir na n'og, a How, La Familia Hort, and a few other games. We took a moment to pick up copies of the Holiday Hijinks games we were missing, and we grabbed the new Endangered Escape Room game, the one about the Galapagos Penguins, and didn't spend a lot of time chatting with Mark and let him just get back to selling more games. His booth was extremely popular.
Yeah, I know. I went by there a couple times because I wanted to chat with him. I'm like, busy, too busy, still too busy. So yeah, his booth was hopping.
So another panel I got to attend was Luke Gygax. Now, this wasn't an interview panel with Craig. This was his own sort of description. And it was basically growing up Gygax was the concept. And you learned a lot about, you know, he, as you would expect, gets a lot of questions like, what was it like to be living with Gary Gygax and growing up with Gary mm-hmm. Gygax? And Luke is the youngest of the Gygax children and had a lot of stories and you know, history, as well as, you know, some of the great spells, you know, come from Luke's own characters, Melf in particular. So Melf's acid arrow, Melf is Luke's elf. Melf the elf was Luke's own character as a child. And so the Melf spells and other spells like that come from his history and growing up Gygax. So that was an interesting one.
We stopped by the Third World Studios 3WS booth, saw their new game, Mission Control Critical Orbit. This is a cooperative game where each player takes on a different role on the NASA Mission Control team trying to save the Mercury 3 rocket, which missed its reentry point. This looks like a fascinating kind of hard science game with very isometric play for three players. We also got a good look at the deluxe edition of The Stuff of Legend, which we've talked about on the show, and got a glimpse of charcuterie. I will say it was only a glimpse of charcuterie because every time we went by the booth, it was packed with people playing it and doing demos.
And I know charcuterie sold out pretty early into the, I walked by and went, oh, they already have a sign up saying that it's gone pretty early into the con. Mission Control Critical, what I think about interesting about that is that it's specifically a three-player game, and you don't see too many games that are only and specifically for three players. So I thought that's kind of neat. I remember they had a very cool demo booth set up for it down near the RPG section last year, and we never got around checking it out.
Now, not a game, but I did find an awesome hand-stitched banner with a quote from The Hobbit on it, the quote being, if more of us valued food and cheer and song above hoarded gold, it would be a merrier world. I got to say, this would look absolutely awesome in our game room. If you want to look it up and look at the company, it is Natasia Embroidery, but it was sadly out of our price range. And I don't think it was overpriced for something handmade, but a little too rich for our blood.
Everything at that booth was lovely. That was particularly enticing, but like the four-figure price tag is definitely out of my price range for Wobbling in our game room, but it was gorgeous.
Yeah. And at this time I was still away in one of the various panels. That was mostly what I did all of Saturday, was jump between panel to panel to panel.
Meanwhile, we got an overview of Insectarium from Snowbright Studios. We're big fans of the, looks like a great family way abstract game about collecting bugs. And similar to Birds of a Feather, also from Snowbright, but sadly now dead, it does feature awesome, hyper-realistic hand-drawn artwork.
It almost had that, like, Victorian moth guidebook kind of vibe to it. Yeah. There was a lot of moths and bugs. It's the art I liked, the aesthetic I liked, yeah. Then I sat down to learn Freshwater Fly, because I just happened to be walking by, and I saw this fishing-themed game with these neat little reels and stuff, and I had to check it out. It's a highly thematic fishing game where the theming is really tightly tied into the mechanics. I know when we came back by later that afternoon, they're like, she was just floored. You could tell when they're just shocked they've sold their game. She's like, we only have one copy left. Like, where did they go?
So. Yeah, some of the neat thematic stuff here was you chose which fly to use and where to cast in the river based on the various catches that were there. And then you would roll to see if you got your fish. And if you failed, you then had to go downriver, moving down further cards. And then you would roll again and move a little further down until you got a catch. And then once you had a catch, there was this neat mechanic where you had to spin your reel. And it was an action selection system. So you would roll the die and you would move it so many spaces and get a bonus based on when you landed. And every time you got a full circle, 360 degrees, you would move the fish card closer on your board. And some fish were, you'd catch them after only one reel and another one was three reels. And for someone who's not a fisherman at all, but someone who was obsessed with fishing games on the PlayStation at one point where they used the little controller to spin around, I was really tempted to pick this one up. But again, sold out. So congrats to the publisher.
Now, one thing I didn't get a chance to see this year at Origins, but I have in the past, and do recommend, and I just want to mention for everyone who's thinking about going to Origins in the future, is the musicians and other entertainers mm-hmm. that are there. There were five different musical groups that were playing sometimes multiple sessions throughout the weekend there, as well as entertainers like magicians and other comedy acts that were going on. So there's a lot of stuff, some of this after hours, some of this during the day. Interestingly, this year they moved them around a lot more. They were much more spread out. At mm-hmm. one point, the magician I noticed was in one of the pods rather than in any of what were normally considered the stage areas. So that was interesting, interesting layout, but again, proving that they're just getting too busy to make it all easily all in one area like they did in previous years.
And one of the things we did do during the con is take advantage of the Gamma member booth Gamma member lounge. If you are a Gamma member, use this room. Unfortunately, we didn't find out about it until Saturday and wish we had known all the time, because one of the most precious things in the world was in there, and that was coffee until 6 p.m. Addition to that, Foam Brain had a nice booth set up where you could check out their stuff. They were the premier sponsor this year, so you got to look at and touch some of the Foam Brain stuff. And it was just a place where Gamma members were coming and going and interacting with each other. So it was a great place to meet other Gamma members and chill and hang out. And the reason I mention this is at one point I was chilling in that room, and across the hall was a folk magician, musician playing, and I felt really bad for them because their music sounded fantastic, and I think there were four people in the room. So really, yes, check out the musicians, check out those other things that aren't games. You can't game all the time, and sometimes you need to get off your feet. Why not go chill in a room with some great music? Getting back to gameplays, though, Deanna and I played a full game of Vegetable Stock at the Arcane Wonders booth. This is a ridiculously fast-playing, fast to learn economic game, and I would say the fastest to play and fastest to learn economic game I've ever played. Reminded me of Point Salad, but it was even quicker to learn and play. We would have tried to bring a copy home of this if it was out already. Unfortunately, we were at the booth and I thought it was something they had available. No, it was actually just another preview promo. Now, I do think it was complete. I don't think we played a prototype, but super simple game where a number of cards go out in the market. They have three vegetables on them. Every round, the players are all going to draft a card, and those are who they own stocks in. And then the third adjusts the prices of the vegetables on it, and things could bust and reset. It was like, for a quick playing economic game, this was fantastic. I thought it was absolutely fascinating in one of those, wow, this is just neat. How did no one think of this before?
Someone I had talked to at some point earlier in the weekend had said, of the games I've seen, one of the ones you want to check out is Vegetable Stock. And I already had it on my short list, so I was like, okay, I want to make sure I go get an overview of this game, which ended up being an entire full game. Mo and I sat down to play it. The booth reps at the time were busy. So grabbed the rulebook. And Mo read and figured out the game in like 2.5 minutes. We got it set up and started playing by the time someone came by, and we went, pretty sure we got it. He's like, did you get this? We're like, yep. He went away. We're playing. Somebody else, the second fellow came by and was like, hey, did you need a teach? We're like, no, we got it. So, I mean, it was super quick to pick up. It was, you could explain. And then we ended up, the next couple came along and sat down as we were leaving, and we taught it to them as we were exiting. I'm like, I can explain this game to you in about a minute and a half. But yeah, it's a very simple but strategic stock economic card game. It was neat.
Next, we had a nice meeting with Allplay and their rep and got a sneak peek at what's coming. The big one for people who know Allplay is a new box size. Oh my God. That's a big deal because they have these like built-in bookcases they bring to the con because their games only come in certain sizes. Well, they're doing micro games now. Now, note these aren't super tiny, you know, bubblegum pack sized, but they're about the size of a card deck. We saw four small card games. There was Prey, which of them seemed the coolest. It's a trick-taking game where they have different values on the back of the card, and you start off playing the Predator side. Then halfway through the game, you flip your hand and have to play the Predator side. That looked awesome. We got to see Rainbow, which was a hand management game where the sets of cards you played one round became the points you could win in the next round. So that was a neat twist. Fairy, which was one of those guessing games where you're trying to guess the next card, if it's going to be higher or lower, the same suit as the current card, or you can take a chance on bidding. It's a fairy. Then we played Panda Panda, which was another hand management game. But this one, you were trying to make specific hands worth different points, which really reminded me of Mahjong with all its weird special hands you can score. And then we got to see Lure, which is a new game in the oldest, smallest box series, if that makes sense. This was a dice bidding fishing game where the person who bid the less dice got the first ones to go try to get their catch. But then if they failed, the next person got a chance to catch fish. And it had some cool thematic tie-ins as well.
Yeah, little did I know I would find two tightly themed fishing games on this expedition. Prey is the one that caught my interest the most out of all of these games as well. And I think in this small box games, the cards were a little more narrow, not quite like a Xylitar card, but not a full width card either, if I'm remembering correctly. Sure. So they were a unique size.
We stopped by the Inside Up booth, the Canadian publisher that we really enjoy the games of. We chatted a bit with Connor and got a good look at Terminus. Terminus is a new heavy root building game that unfortunately is not coming until later this year. This looked like a Deanna game for sure.
Yeah, it's a good sign when I walk up and the person that's demoing the game is like, "You like heavy games?" And I went, "Yes." And he went, "Oh, good. Let me tell you about this one." But I think, you know, and it sort of has a dry, heavy-ish look to it when you look at it. So I was like, this is a good sign. I'm going to go over and check out this game. It's a neat looking game. I'm bad at giving game overviews, so I'm not even going to bother trying. But it was definitely one that I would like to check out.
Yeah, it was neat. It was kind of a city route building game where you're building paths to different buildings and then building buildings as well. There was just a lot going on, a lot about one of the big things in it was there's a finite economy. So there was only so much energy available and so much construction available, and you'd be competing for what you could get. Now, Connor was cool enough to hook us up with a review copy of Earth. So I am really looking forward to this one. I know some of the local gamers have it and we've seen it at our gaming events, but I am looking forward to trying this game out with all the awards and accolades it's got. I really need to get this one to the table.
Yeah, I'm going to go back to Terminus. So it was very tight economy. And then it had the little thing at the top where your guys moving around the subway route kind of thing. And that determined what actions you could take. So that was interesting too. Earth is one I've wanted to play for a long time. I checked out a cool word game called Sequitur. It has these round letters that are going to an almost pea pod shaped thing. And the game is all about manipulating the order of the letters in the pea pod in front of you to try and hit certain types of words and to get the scores for the end of the game. And that looked fascinating. I think it was just a little indie publisher I had not heard of before. I would have to look up the name.
Now, one of the neat things in that one that I liked is everyone had their own word thing, but you were all working towards the same goals. So I thought that was a nice touch.
And that's by Catmint Games.
Thank you, Sean. Over at the Chip Theory Games booth, we learned a bit about some brand confusion with the Hoplomachus games. The last year, we actually spent some time in the booth checking out Hoplomachus Victorum, which is a solo game that really caught Deanna's eye. Well, this year we get to the booth and there's this on display as Hoplomachus Remastered. but it didn't look anything like Victorum. So we asked about it. Well, it ends up Hoplomachus is like a line of games. There's a whole bunch of games in this series, which originally started with Hoplomachus Rise of Rome. Well, Victorum is a standalone solo game that actually isn't attached to the other games except for being in like the same time period. So it ends up remastered is actually the latest release of Hoplomachus Rise of Rome, which is from like 2013. So it's like a revised version of that. Now it includes rule updates, previous expansions, and more.
So yeah, there was a bit of confusion there for a minute because I clearly remembered that the reason I did not get Hoplomachus Victorium last year was that it was a solo game and I rarely have time to play solo games. And I went to this, what I thought was the second edition of the game, and they started talking about two player, blah, 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 and all this. I went, no, I swear this was a solo game. Like something's not quite on here. So it took us a bit to figure it out. We're talking back and forth with the guy and then we went, oh, okay. After learning about Hoplomachus, we also just moved one table over and got a demo of Cloudspire, which is a MOBA in board game form. It was interesting.
Yeah, it was one of those games where like you have your fortress, the opponent has their fortress over a bunch of terrain in the middle, and every round you're going to produce more units and move them towards. And what was fascinating on this one is you didn't control the units. It was very much a video game in board game form, because when you spawned a unit, you picked their target. And then they just kept going towards their target. And there was a whole thing about changing the terrain. Really neat looking game. And like I said, I think they did a really good job of doing that real-time strategy thing, but in board game form. We were really curious about that one.
And super asymmetric, which is one of the things I dug about it.
Well, during all that game playing was going on, there was a cosplay competition going on. Now, unfortunately, due to a little bit of mixed messaging from Origins versus what was actually going on, the cosplayers ended up lining up a little bit earlier than they needed to, and there was some stress over that. The room they were in this year for the cosplay competition was much better lit, so everyone was able to get much better photographs of the actual competitors and winners of it. Unfortunately, they had basically double the number of entrants they had last year. And so they had sized down the room a little bit and upped the attendance by a lot. So The room was very, very crowded. The air conditioning, which had been fantastic throughout the rest of the week, despite the heat wave we were in, really was kind of overloaded by that audience. And yet everyone, I think, for the most part, had a great time. The cosplay competition was fantastic. Again, thank you to Rubber City Cosplay for hosting a wonderful event and all the entrants and competitors and audience for making it an enjoyable experience, I think, for everyone involved. Do take a look at my Instagram, or if you check me out on Facebook or in the Origins groups, for photos from that as well. Rubber City Cosplay will be having photos from their photographer for the event.
Sean got so many cool pictures. If you're at least even vaguely interested, go check it out.
Next, we tried out a couple of games at the All Play demo area, like out in the game hall. The first with Things and Rings, which was a rather unique Venn diagram game, though very different from other picture association games. One player gets three rules and then places three cards inside or outside the rings, making sure to follow the rules. Each ring relates to one of the three rules. Players then take turns placing cards into the rings or outside, hoping to figure out the rules. If they place a card correctly, they get to go again. But if they place one in the wrong spot, the knower then moves the card to the proper spot and they draw a card. First player to empty their hand wins.
It's a neat concept and it's got a very Dr. Seuss vibe to it, but I don't know, this one didn't do it for me.
Now, for those of you who are Patreon patrons or considering it, I did post a first thoughts review of Things and Rings on our Patreon today, which you can find at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. If you do care to learn a bit more of my first thoughts.
And hint, I think Mo liked it better than I did.
From there, we played a full game of Kabuto Sumo, which I really enjoyed. This is a great looking game, kind of based on those coin machines you find at Redemption Arcades where you throw a quarter in and hope it pushes a whole pile of quarters off the other side. That's the inspiration for this game. So you've got this wooden kind of table set up in front of you, and each turn you're going to slide a disc onto this sumo ring, trying to knock your opponent's beetle off. Now, it features asymmetric wrestlers with an interesting economic system for buying upgrades and abilities based on the characters. And that was a big surprise to me, because it's way more than just pushing discs on a table.
I did not expect to like this game, and I actually really enjoyed it.
That's awesome.
I was trying to describe it to Mo as, it's not manual decks. He's like, but it is. And I'm like, well, it's not speed-based manual decks. Like, it's slow, methodical manual decks. Apparently, I can manage that.
Yeah, I was back. This was actually after the cosplay competition. So I was back taking some photographs and watching this one get played. And I have to admit, it was more engaging than I had expected. I hadn't really thought much about this game. I know it got a lot of buzz when it first came out. But again, you're pushing discs onto a platform. It doesn't really sound that much. But seeing the rest of it, all those different characters you can play and the other aspects of it really makes it more interesting.
Yeah, let's just say this is not the first time Mo has tried to get me to play this game. And I obviously should have listened to him earlier.
The same area, we got a short demo of Pollen. Now, this is an area majority game about collecting bug meeples. And you do this by surrounding insect tokens with cards that have flowers on them that appeal to the different bugs. And what I really liked about this game is the tactile nature of it. The bug tokens are great looking because they're like these domed shaped like displays with two insects inside of them. And when you surround them with flowers, you score them and then you flip them over. And because they're dome shaped, you get this very 3D thing because on the other side they have flower blooms. And I just really liked the look of this game, and it had some really clever area majority area control mechanics.
One of the things I loved about the All Play booth that was in the expo hall was that they had these banners over each of their demo tables that just gave you a description of the gameplay. And it was like area majority, hand shedding, trick taking, you know, whatever it was, right? Co-op trick taking. And that is way cooler than knowing this is a game about bugs and flowers. I thought that was really well done. And if I remember correctly, this game is a Nizia game, which was another cool point for it.
Yeah, this one was beautiful. I can't speak to the gameplay, but it just really stood out as a gorgeous game with great art and great components.
End of the day, Saturday ended with, for me, what was the biggest surprise of the con? We were checking out the Catalyst Game Labs booth, which was mostly filled with Battletech and Battletech players and super long games that have been running all day long. And we spotted the Duke off in their board game corner. And I started talking to one of the people in the booth about how it's our favorite two-player game of all time. Someone who was shopping at the time heard me and was like, what's that? And bought a copy right then. So that was kind of cool. And we're over there and Deanna picks up another game sitting next to it with like a Roman Centurion on it. And the game's called Centurion, and flips it over. And she's like, Mo, and she hands me the box backwards. I'm like, what the heck? The Duke. Like, seriously, this is another version of the Duke. So then I walk over to Sean, who was over, I think he was taking pictures of a Battletech table. And I'm like, check this out. We didn't know this existed. And Sean flips it over and I literally see his jaw drop. So what we had discovered is that at some point they published a third standalone game in the Duke series that is also backwards compatible with the Duke and Jarl and everything else that's been put out for it. Now, again, this has a Roman theme, and the really unique thing in this compared to the other versions is a new ability called Formation, where activating one tile, it can pair up with other tiles next to it, and then they all move the way the first tile does, which fits for a Roman-themed game with legions. Of course, we brought home a copy, and I got to say it was nice because Catalyst was very happy to hand it over after hearing about how much we talk about the Duke, and I'm sure having made a sale for them while in the booth probably helped a bit too.
I am floored that I did not already know that this game existed. Yeah. Like, how did we not know that there was, let alone a third expansion to the Duke, that we did not already possess? Okay. Roman theme. I mean, come on. I'm super excited to get this one to the table. We opened it up and took a look at it, but I was far too burned out to play a game at that point.
Yeah, it's pretty wild to think of that there's an expansion to a game that's literally like in our, you know, in our show, every single show is the Duke is there behind me that we, you know, then we've recommended any number of times and we had no idea. about this is this existence.
I think I was legitimately burnt out because I walked so much on Saturday or over the course of the con that I broke my shoe sole in half. Mo took a photo and posted it online. I literally broke through my darn shoes.
So now on to Origins Game Fair, day 5, Sunday, the end.
So Sunday started off with a demo game of Honey Buzz, including the new Fall Flavors expansion. This one's from Elf Creek Games, and the demo had all the shiny upgrades. For anyone who doesn't know Elf Creek Games, they are all about being able to bling out your games. And man, does this game look good once it's fully upgraded. What was even more impressive, though, is the gameplay. This is a very solid worker bee placement and economic game about building a hive and selling money. It's got lots of neat things going on, and the Fall Harvest expansion just adds more options. And this is one we keep seeing at cons, but never actually sat down to get a demo. And this is a, why didn't we try this sooner?
The demo tables are usually full when we walk by for one reason, but I'm going to be honest and say, I thought this game was going to be gimmicky. It's just about cool pieces and all the little upgrade components you can get in very, very Kickstarter game, right? And then we sat down and checked it out, and I went, oh my gosh, this is so good. I'm so hooked on this. And I just, we played a short demo game, and I just wanted to play more and play it again. I love the way that you build your hive. Every time you complete like a honeycomb in your hive, you do the actions that are on the tiles that you have used to build around that hive, and the way that you would plan out your turns around that, the worker bee system, the way you get more bee. I don't know, just I loved all of it. And it's way cooler than just 3D plastic pumpkins, which is the Fall expansion. But
yeah, it had a really smart economy too, where you could sell all of one type of honey at once, but every time you sold honey, the value dropped. So there was this kind of push your luck chicken thing where you're mm-hmm. like, well, yeah, I can make buckwheat honey right now and sell it for $7. But then the price will drop to $6. Or maybe I try to get 2 or 3 buckwheat honey and sell it what's at $7. But then when your opponent goes in and sells only one, so now it's not worth as much. Like, it had a clever economic system. And then there was this almost exploration feel where you moved your queen bee around the map to collect different tiles and you collect fruit. There was just a lot more going on than I expected from the game.
And the way the market worked really made me feel like more than some market games, market-driven games that we've played, that it worked well with 2 players. And yes. Again, not that we played out a full game, but it felt like it worked really well at 2.
So Sunday was a little more relaxing day for me. I spend my days on Sunday as a sort of gamekeeper, because again, Sundays are the day when most publishers are willing to give out copies that they haven't managed to sell yet to reviewers, and walking around with those can be a pain. So I spend my Sundays over at the cosplay area, chatting with people and making some more contacts, and possibly even getting some photography gigs out of it, while Mo and Dee hook up with all the publishers that have said, come see us on Sunday.
Next up, before we were doing our end of day collection, we did play a full game of Wandering Towers, which I've wanted to try after it won an Origins Award. This is a very solid welcome mat game with some fun mechanics, very gateway, family friendly. There's a bunch of towers on the map, and you have a bunch of little wizards that you put on them. And every turn, you either move your wizards or one of the towers. And when you move the tower, of course, everyone on it moves. And while the tower is stacked in a way where you can trap and hide people underneath. And the goal of the game is to, at some point, trap, cover up 4 meeples, which could be your own, with the towers, and then also get your meeples into the keep, which was a special black tower that always was the top of a stack. I was quick playing, looks great, featured a lot of replayability as there were these spells that you could randomize every game that kind of changed the rules, the way which were based on you fill your potions for trapping people, you can then spend them to do things. I thought it was really neat and a good gateway game, probably be good for our public play events.
It's at its heart, it's a memory game. You're covering up meeples and you want to remember what colors are under there and where your guys are, and you're going around and, you know, variable movement. I don't know. It was not for me. I did not enjoy it and had no urge to ever play it again, to be honest.
Next, we wandered over to the Arcane Wonders booth again and tried out GAP, G-A-P. This is a very quick playing set collection game where you're playing cards to collect cards, which is kind of interesting. And there were some neat mechanics there, but I'm not going to get into the details. The important part was at the end of the game, you scored your biggest set of cards minus your smallest set of cards. You're scoring the gap, which was the whole theme of the game. This was way thinkier than it sounds and quite fun. This is another one that I think would be good for a public play event.
Yeah, the way when you played out cards, like say if you played a two, then you would get to collect a two. But if you played a two and there were no twos out there, and only if there were no twos out there, you could collect the cards to either side, the one or the three, and you would collect all the ones and all the threes, and you have to place them in the appropriately colored rows. And then your biggest set isn't necessarily your highest scoring set. It's the one that has the most cards in it. And then you take your biggest set minus your smaller set, and that's your end game scoring. It was neat. It was quick. And I enjoyed it. I actually really liked that one.
The interesting little detail about this game is its alternate name, the alternate name for GAP is FUK. So I'm not sure what language that comes from or what it means in that language. But wow, no wonder they changed the name for the English publication.
It's not backstabbing game.
See, I don't know, because when I calculated my final score, I definitely pronounced the name of the game the other way because I had a large gap. Next up was our last big meeting of the con, and that was with Monica from Cephalofair Games. Of course, everyone knows Isaac and his company and one of the biggest games in the world. I don't know if it's still the Board Game Geek number one, but it was up there for a long time. There's something they want us to get out, so I'm going to do it right here. The biggest takeaway of this is that Gloomhaven 2nd Edition is not a new printing of Gloomhaven, nor is it just a reworking of Gloomhaven or an errata fixed version of Gloomhaven. This is a new game. They have totally redone every single character. They've added a ton of new scenarios. They've added a faction system, which totally changes the end of the game. This is not just Gloomhaven, and they very much want people to know that this is something that even people who have and have played through the entire first game are going to want to pick up. And yes, we told them and their booth people and people wandering by that they really should rename it if this is the case.
Yeah, I had no clue. No clue. I assumed this was Gloomhaven smoothed out the rough edges for people who haven't played Gloomhaven yet. Not Gloomhaven, you want to go grab it and play it. She was describing, like, at some point, we have an infographic that she's supposed to send us. It shows the exact number breakdown, but it was like 110 new events. This many revised and like two that are still from the old game. Like, the amount of stuff that was from the original game was minuscule. Yeah. I guess the overarching story plot line is the same, but then all the details are different. And there's even a new end boss, like, new monsters and new, like, All kinds of stuff. I was shocked by it.
Well, one of the things, the story arc is no longer just good or evil. It's now faction based, and the ending is different. That's the most important. You're not going to get to the same end.
Also, I guess if you take your first edition Gloomhaven characters and try and play them in Frosthaven, you will get your butt handed to you. So supposedly these characters are completely balanced. They've been rebalanced and will work well if you port them to Frosthaven.
Yeah, the other thing that's worth noting is, I wanted to know this, it ends up that Jaws of the Lion came out enough into the development of this that those characters are built to port. So one of the big things that'll happen is right now you can do Jaws of the Lion into Frosthaven. You technically can do Frosthaven into Gloomhaven, the original, but it might be too easy. But you can't do Gloomhaven into Frosthaven. Well, that'll be fixed. And once second edition Gloomhaven is out, you can totally mix and match your characters between the games.
I think like they should have named it Gloomhaven Volume 2 or Gloomhaven Attack of the something. I don't know. Something different.
Gloomhaven 2 Electric Boogaloo, right? Yeah. As everyone likes to make the joke. The best I heard was Gloomhaven Revised, I think is one of the better suggestions I heard, because it Remastered. Is still Gloomhaven. It's still got the same character classes. Like, I actually sat down and looked through the Craig Hart deck, because that was the first character class I played, and it was very different than what I'd seen. Plus, the card layout's just better, and the information is better, and they highlight things you must do and what's optional. Obviously, they've learned a lot since the first game that came out. I just wish it was a little more clear that this is something Gloomhaven fans who have finished the game should be interested. Now, we did leave this mini with a review copy of Buttons and Bugs. So expect to hear more about that game in the future.
It's so cute. It's so tiny. It also looks like fun, but it's so cute.
It's interesting because as they were at the Cellophare booth, I was sitting down with the husband of one of the cosplayers who was playing his game of Bugs and Buttons. And we were discussing our content of the FAQ for Gloomhaven.
Now, our last demo of the con was a ridiculously quick look at Dungeon Cart from Brotherwise Games, which is Mario Kart in the Boss Monster universe. It features a really cool gear-based movement where every round you have to adjust your gear up or down, asymmetric carts, variable maps, and lots of interesting power-up tokens. The lesson learned here is don't try to get a demo 20 minutes before the hall closes. I will say it looked cool, but I would like to have learned a little bit more about the game.
No, that gentleman was done. He actually tried to show us a piece of the game. It was like, yeah, and this part's like reversible, and forgot that there was chits all over it and just dumped them everywhere. And he's like, I'll pick them up. Don't, like, he was just so done.
No offense to the Brotherwise crew.
Oh, no. I'm sure everyone was exhausted by that time. Many people were very, very done at that point. I had compassion for this fellow. He just looks so burnt out. But yeah, don't go by in the last 20 minutes and say, hey, can I get an overview of this? Because everyone just wants to clean up and go home.
And then, as Sean mentioned, most of Sunday was actually meeting up with people who said, come back Sunday, and collecting review copies. I said this earlier. I was going to share a picture of it, but I can't do it live anymore. But we're much pickier this year and brought home less than half of what we did last year. Now, it still ended up being more than we planned, but I will say we're very hyped about what we did bring home.
Yep, we've got so many awesome games lined up in those cubbies behind Mo that I cannot wait to play.
And that was it for Origins Game Fair 2024 for us. And that was the double bell.
That means it's time to close the doors on this con wrap-up episode. Make sure to grab all of your stuff as you leave your hall and toss out your garbage in the receptacle by the door.
As you head out, let's all take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Carlos, thank you, Tycho.
Valentine Page, thank you.
Chris Leary, thank you, Chris.
Diane Tuzano, thanks, Ma.
Brian Sheehan, thank you, Brian.
Dukas, thank you.
Well, now that we've come, now that we're home, the best place to find us is at tabletopbellhop.com. But we're all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
And in Gen Con, look great while gaming by wearing some Tabletop Bellhop merch. We've got golf shirts, t-shirts, mugs, and more. Just head to tabletopbellhop.com/merch. Buy any two items and use the code TABLETOP to save on shipping.
If you enjoyed this episode, be sure to subscribe on Spotify or Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. And please tell your friends and fellow gamers about our show. That's all for us for tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
Thank you.
And game on.